WIBC HD2 W298BB WIBC HD3 W228CX Indianapolis.
It's Kevin and Querry.
I throw, you catch. It's not that hard, okay? All right, get the out of here.
I'm going to talk a lot about drills and fundamentals.
Watch it, watch it, watch it, watch it.
On 93.5.
Watch it.
And 107.5.
Boom, baby.
The Fan.
Big night for hoops here in the city of Indianapolis and around the state. And I guess we got to go to not only Bloomington, but Tallahassee and out in Sacramento as well. Hinkle, a little action as Butler takes on undefeated Kansas State tonight. Good Wednesday morning to you. Kevin Bowen, Jake Querry, Mark Dykton. A much wintry-like start to this Wednesday than it was yesterday, temperature-wise. And, you know, I almost find it fitting, Jake, that with the Colts in such a, hey, where are they at in the draft order right now? You look at tonight and you're like, whoa, there's a lot of appointment television. Now, we are going to have to stay up a little late to get it all in, but a great night for hoops around the state.
Yeah, let me ask you this. We alluded to this the other day with the Big Ten ACC Challenge coming to an end, but with North Carolina, and I know that people are jazzed. I mean, I know people whose kids are like, and I'm going to be old man getting off the lawn here in a second, but or get off my lawn in a second. But does the Indiana-North Carolina game at all, I don't really think it does, but does it lose any oomph just because Carolina has slid a little bit in the rankings?
Yeah. Yeah.
You think so?
I would say. I mean, if you look at the four big games Indiana has in the non-conference, at Xavier, tonight obviously with Carolina, Arizona and Las Vegas coming up in a few weeks, and then your old stomping grounds, Allen Fieldhouse, kind of in mid-December. This is the, in my opinion, this is the easiest of the four. The fact that it's the only one at Assembly Hall probably adds a little juice. And, you know, I think any time you're a college basketball fan, you're looking for these non-conference home games with great atmospheres and all of that. The Armando Bacot, assuming he's healthy, matchup with Trace Jackson Davis, of course, is one to watch. So, I mean, it still has a lot of appeal, but I think it has lost a little bit of its luster. Now, although Bob Knight was at practice yesterday, right?
I saw that.
Ted Kitchell, Randy Whitman, and Christian Watford in the building.
Okay, allow me to point out one thing, and I'm going to be the I'm going to sound like the fun police, but I think deep down, hopefully, people will be like, "Yeah, you're probably right." You ready? When it gets especially when it gets unreasonably cold outside, I think it's a little ridiculous that Indiana University both requires to an extent and allows students to camp outside of Assembly Hall to get the best seats for a game. Is that the fun police?
That's the fun police.
Am I wrong, Kevin?
He ran up on my lawn. Like get him off my lawn.
So my understanding is that the Bloomington police came and told kids that they couldn't have tents. So they're like sleeping in sleeping bags. I'm like, it's 30 degrees outside.
Yeah, this is news to me. I don't understand how the student ticket.
Well, when I may be off base.
Gates open and you sprint to your seats.
When I was in school, you got, again, a long time ago, but you got, as a student, you got tickets for six games. You knew that two games were going to be behind the basket. You knew that two games were going to be in the upper level of the lower level. And you knew that two games were going to be in the balcony. And it was just a crapshoot of like, oh my gosh, I got Michigan State and I'm behind the basket. Or, you know, people would say like, this is my behind the basket game. It was a big deal.
Yeah, I think it was similar for me.
And I get it. I mean, they wanted to increase the student population in attendance at the games. I totally get it and understand it, and I'm glad students have that opportunity. Don't get me wrong. And I may be totally off base. Somebody with kids down there can correct me, but in talking, you know, obviously I'm at the age that a lot of my friends have kids that go to school there, and they talk about how their kids are like camping out or waiting in line. You know, oh, the coaching staff brought donuts for them this morning because they've been camping out for 2 days, you know, sleeping in front of Assembly Hall. And I'm like, are you seriously? It's the wintertime. It just doesn't seem.
Yesterday was balmy for them there.
It was. No, it was great yesterday.
I chalked that up to college. I'm not too worried about them. I think they will make it through that. And it will be a tremendous atmosphere, even with North Carolina losing a couple games out in Portland. I thought I saw they flew straight from Portland to Bloomington.
That would make sense, probably, right? I mean, they
had the quadruple overtime game. Remember right. That? And they only go like six or seven deep, and Bacot got hurt. So I think if Indiana can, you know, I think a theme we've seen in Mike Woodson's second year, They've gone into their bench, and their bench has played very well this season. I think if you can do that, obviously Carolina wants to run. It's always been their MO, but I think if IU can kind of tap into that, that'll be something to keep an eye on. Purdue, Florida State, that's at 7:15 tonight. IU, North Carolina, 9:15. Florida State is horrific, and I feel like this is the 17th straight year Purdue's played Florida State in the ACC Big Ten Challenge.
It does feel like every year, right? Or NC State. Isn't NC State like in that mix every once in a while?
My senior year, Indiana was at NC State. That was one of the bigger wins of the Green Era. No, we did not travel to that one.
That would be a cool one.
I always like how the students are real close there, right behind the both benches.
NC State had a great basketball tradition, obviously, from, you know, Valvano, and then you go back to David Thompson and I think David Thompson was NC State, right? I always get that confused with Daryl Griffith. But, in 74, defeating UCLA, I mean, Norm Sloan, NC State had a great tradition. It's obviously kind of tapered off a little bit, but I still think of NC State as a legit, like, top 25 program. Am I off base there?
I would think so.
Oh, you would think I'm off base, or you would agree with that?
That they are.
Like on the fringe, right?
Oh, no, that you're off base. Sorry. Haven't they struggled? Didn't they go from, like, Mark Gottfried to...
That's what I mean. I mean, I think that they've really tried to find an identity and just really just... They're like Minnesota now. You know what I mean?
Cheating or something?
Yeah.
Yeah, Butler's got undefeated Kansas State tonight. 3-3. That was the first night of the Big Ten ACC Challenge. Illinois smoked Syracuse. Marquette... Well, this isn't Big Ten ACC. Marquette beat Baylor by 26 last night. That's number 6 Baylor, so that's good for the Purdue resume. Virginia and Wake both won road games at Michigan, at Wisconsin. And Louisville's 0-7.
How about that, man? I mean...
And they're getting...
How is that possible, Kevin? How's that possible?
I thought I saw a stat yesterday. I think Cal might also be 0-7. They are the only Power 5 programs to start a season 0-7 in, like, eons.
Did Louisville... I don't know the inner workings of Louisville basketball. I've always kind of liked Louisville. But from the outside, and I'm sure there are people that follow Louisville basketball closely that can correct me or tell me, you know, so I'm just going by what the... I'm telling Louisville what the perception of them could be. It seems to me like Louisville is a program that kind of sold itself out because they got paranoid and felt like they needed to go out and get a coach with Louisville ties that had the whole, like, AAU connections and NBA connections to be able to get 5 stars from around the country to, like, fall in love with Louisville. And that they just went out and found a guy that had a connection to the university that, I mean, I guess they started themselves over and hit a complete reset. But Louisville just feels like one of those programs that, and I guess Indiana went through it when Tom Crean first got there, and Purdue went through it when Matt Painter first got there and they made the transition from Katy. But doesn't Louisville feel like one of those programs that just falls out of bed and automatically should at least be 500?
Yeah, I mean, they had some just awful teams with Chris Mack and now this.
But I don't think Chris Mack was terrible last year,
no,
was he?
No, I mean, not to this. I mean, obviously 0-7 to this extent, but Kenny Payne's first season down there, off to an absolutely horrific start. Pacers and Kings. Our coverage will begin at 9:30. So if you're looking for Indiana and North Carolina tonight, WIBC for that one. Pre-game coverage at 8:15. Pacers and Kings, 9:30 tonight. Jake, we've got tons of storylines in this one.
The Kings were one that got out, like the Pacers, to a huge start.
Yeah.
And great expectation, young team, and now they've lost 3 in a row.
Sabonis, of course, against Turner. Tyrese Halliburton and Buddy Hield going back to Sacramento for their first time. And we saw how Benedict Mathurin reacted to playing Jaden Ivey earlier this season. I would guess, although they don't play the same position, I guess he'd have a similar reaction to playing Keegan Murray.
You're right.
Tonight. Keegan Murray averaging 10 points, 4 rebounds, shooting hair over 30% from behind the arc this season.
So not quite where they probably were hoping he'd be at this point, right?
Yeah, I would say that's fair.
Not quite Benedict Mathurin. Let's put it that way.
Crazy, we're a fourth of the way through the NBA season.
You're a fourth of the way to your money, buddy.
Oh, no, better than that. Come on now.
You're almost halfway there, right?
So what is this, 12?
You're 40% there.
12 of 30. So we're at the 25% mark of the season. I'm 40% there.
Yeah. That's good. Yesterday, by the way, and good morning to you. I don't know if Kevin said that. My name is Jake Query. That is Kevin Bowen, Mark Dykton here as well. It is Kevin and Query on a Wednesday here on 93.5, 107.5 The Fan. As Kevin had mentioned, probably do want to grab yourself the jacket on the way out, although it's not terrible, but after last night's unseasonably warm weather, you're going to walk out and go, oh, it's back down to the 30s. Yesterday afternoon, it was cool. I watched the better part of it between the U.S. and Iran, and that was one of those matches that I'm not a soccer aficionado by any stretch, Kevin, but it did kind of feel like the United States controlled it for the better part. Would you agree?
Yeah, particularly in the first half. Particularly in the first half. I've gotten my soccer updates via Tyler Kiever, coaches at DePaul, and asked him for his thoughts on the game. He goes, wild ride, great first half, came out with the energy needed to win the game, wish they would have put the game away. I think he means adding another goal there. Another great goal, which looked exactly like the way they wanted to exploit Iran. Netherlands is beatable, but we'll have to put together two halves like the first half. Going to need two goals to advance to the quarterfinals, which I believe they've only done once as a country.
I looked it up, and
Saturday at 10 a.m.
Netherlands, by the way, ranked 8th, I believe, in the FIFA rankings. The United States, 16th. So, yeah, I mean, it's...
Sounds like similar to England, who the U.S. faced a little bit, on Friday, I guess. Maybe not as good as England, and the Netherlands were in, I would say, probably the easiest group.
Now, may I ask a really dumb question, and you guys can mock me if you'd like? Sure. Now that they have advanced out of the pool, I'm setting myself up here for people to literally pull their car over and go, the guy's the biggest moron on the planet. I know there's 16 teams left. Are there pools again, or is it now a 16-team, like, round-robin?
Yeah, we got a bracket. We got a bracket now. 16 okay. teams. Sweet 16.
Right.
Here we go. So these matches will now go to extra time, penalty kicks, all of that. We don't end in ties anymore.
So this is what happened in 2012, right? They made it out of pool, and then they played in the bracket. And if I'm not mistaken, Portugal, they...
I thought it was 2014 with Belgium.
Or 2014, I'm sorry.
Tim Howard was saving everything.
But they also played Portugal, right?
Maybe.
Because they played Ronaldo. Didn't they tie...
Maybe that was in the group stage, or was that in the
tie? Can you tie in this round, or do you go to penalty kicks?
Well, if you tie, you go to penalty kicks.
That's what I mean. You go to penalty kicks, right? So I want to say that they... Did the United States beat Portugal? Are you looking this up, Mark? I don't know why I'm thinking that they had... Either Belgium or Portugal, they defeated, and like everybody went crazy.
I remember the Belgium game being just Tim Howard incredible, and they lost in extra time to them. And again, I think they've been to the quarterfinals just once.
Okay. Now, the Netherlands, I saw that Ari Leijendijk was asking who he should root for. So let me ask you. I don't know. I would assume that Leijendijk is now a U.S. citizen. But if you grow up in the Netherlands... And you lived in the Netherlands until you were an adult, a young adult, and then eventually your career brought you to the United States where you have raised your family. I assume that Leijendijk is now a U.S. citizen. Which team, if you're Leijendijk, which team should, if he had to wear one hat, which one should, would you?
I think he's got to wear the Dutch, right?
I would think, right? I mean, it's your home.
Now,
I mean,
his children may be different.
Correct. They all grew up in Arizona.
Yeah, you know, I'm always...
Home is home, though, right?
It shows my sports fandom. I'm already thinking, like, man, are Rosie and Max going to follow the teams that I like? They better. You know, just like, I don't know why I, like, think about that stuff.
Now, what would you do if...
Like, if Max became a USC fan, I'd probably have to... I'd have to think long and hard about supporting
him
to the
age of
18.
Well, think about if your son becomes a fan of the University of Southern California, then the good news is the money that you made off of the 2022-2023 Pacers, you get to go ahead and spend on a trip to Vegas because you're not paying for his college, right? He's on his own.
You are right. Yes. Okay, that's a good optimistic way
he's emancipated.
Of looking at that.
Now, speaking of fathers, so Leijendijk, one of my favorite stories, I probably told it before, but the year, I was in Edmonton one year. For those that don't know, Ari Leijendijk, the 1990-1997 Indy 500 winner. And we're in Edmonton. We were driving. Ari Leijendijk works for the series now. This was like 2014, around then. And he says to me, like, hey, are you going back to the hotel? I need a ride. I'm like, yeah, sure. So I you know, he gets in the car, and I'm thinking to myself, like, holy cow, like, you know, I better watch my driving here. I mean, Ari Leyendijk is critiquing my driving probably. But we get to the hotel. There was a wedding party going on, and there were all these people milling around, and this young girl in the wedding party who was, this was in Edmonton, very attractive girl, goes bonkers over Ari Leyendijk. Like, can't believe Ari Leyendijk's there. Wants to get a picture with them. I'm sure I've told this story 50 times. I take the picture. Johnny Rutherford walks in, and I'm like, well, you probably want one with him too, huh? Well, he's a three-time Indy 500 winner. I know Leyendijk's a two-time winner, but that guy's won three times. Indy, what are you talking about? And I said, well, it's Ari Leyendijk that you just got the picture taken with, and you're like going gaga over it, and all your friends. And she says, oh, no. I just recognize him from the home visits on The Bachelor. That's Ari Jr.'s dad.
That sounds like Maddie right there.
And it was literally the week of when Ari Jr. was on The Bachelor and da-da-da-da, and that's what they had no idea that he was a race car
driver. I don't think Maddie liked Ari Jr., though.
Yeah, I think he probably came off as fairly arrogant, right?
Now,
good dude, but
should we be impressed by the U.S. going through their three matches so far and they didn't allow a single goal outside of the penalty kick?
Really? I guess you're, so
1-1 with Wales. That was the penalty in the 80-something minute.
Love, and one love, right?
0-0 with England, 0-0. Yeah. And then yesterday, 1-0. 1-0 with Iran. I do.
Yeah, that's impressive.
I did find myself, Jake, and we'll play this Christian Pulisic goal from yesterday. Again, every 4 years, I find myself, to be honest with you, kind of on the edge of my seat yesterday watching that.
Oh, it's very, there's no doubt that soccer is, I understand why people enjoy, you know, to be honest, let me rephrase that. Part of me is like, I don't understand why people enjoy watching this only because it is super tense, right?
Oh my gosh. I mean, it's very like yelling and anxiety, and I'm like, gosh, I can feel gray hairs popping out of my head right now.
Do you remember when you were in school, when you were in elementary school, and you'd be sitting at your desk and you would lean your chair back and your teacher would say, like, you can't do that, you're going to fall backward?
Oh yeah, I definitely had a few falls.
So you would get to the point right when you thought that you were at the point of no return and you'd catch yourself and then grab the desk?
I think I've done that in studio here.
There are times that watching soccer feels like that.
Did you ever grab the desk and then the desk came with you?
Jeez, now that sounds
that
like
happened
a...
to you?
That sounds like you could be on the IR
not a personal
few days.
Did you have the desks that where the desk raises up and you put your books underneath it, or did you have the like little?
It's like a cubby hole and you can slide stuff.
Yeah, that's what we worked with. But you know about Christian Pulisic, Jake, he has been hailed as this LeBron James like savior, and I'm sitting there watching the match yesterday, thinking to myself, boy, this is it for him. I mean, every 4 years, you have one shot at it with how soccer is on a global stage. I know he's a great player for Chelsea and all of that, and you know, I'm sure diehard soccer fans realize that he's a tremendous talent. But to the common American sports fan, you are judged and evaluated by what you do in this World Cup.
Yeah, that's fair.
And the goal he scored yesterday, the assist from Sergiño Dest, if I'm saying that correctly, was a beautiful cross. Pulisic gave up his body. I mean, he got smoked. For a minute there, I'm thinking there's going to be no junior Pulisic's running around. They said later it was a pelvic contusion. Went to the hospital. That was a hell of a goal. And it was unfortunate he couldn't celebrate, because I'm thinking to myself, what relief he probably feels scoring the goal to send them to the knockout round. Because I think in the soccer world, there's got to be just gobs and gobs of pressure on him to deliver. Because again, if he doesn't deliver yesterday and they don't advance, now all of a sudden you're waiting another 4 years and you're always thinking about it.
Okay. Do you want to know another Jake Query dumb soccer question?
Let's hear it.
These are the things that keep me awake at night, by the way. Who gets the World Cup? Like, you name a country off the top of your head. Brazil.
Yeah, I'd assume your federation would get it, right?
I would assume that's where it goes.
Probably,
right?
Everybody gets a little replica.
I mean, does it go in the, like, the actual World Cup itself? The actual, the trophy itself, it is presented to Brazil or, you know, France or whoever. I would assume, like, if the United States were to win the World Cup, where is the United States soccer, like, federation
Miami.
Office?
I have no idea.
I mean, is that where it goes on display?
I would assume.
Or would, like, it go
everybody
to Washington, D.C.?
You think it goes on Biden's front desk?
Yeah, I mean, like, does it go to the Capitol, like, come and see the World Cup? I mean, it's the countries to enjoy.
Well, we'll see if we can get on a run here and find out. Netherlands, Saturday, 10 a.m. Mark, do you have the goal highlight?
I do.
I thought it was a great call. I've really enjoyed the announcers. Here is Christian Pulisic, if I'm saying that correctly. I guess we'll find out. With the goal to send the U.S. to the knockout round.
Robinson, back for the captain, Tyler Adams. Austin McKay, Dest making a big run. It's meant for him. Dest is snuck in behind. Dest into the middle. Pulisic scores! Might have paid the price, but the U.S. takes the lead.
I love that might have paid the price. I think for an announcer, Jake, it paints a picture. He obviously later follows up on it, but I thought Pulisic was dead after he scored the goal. I'm like, is he going to get up?
Because the collision, right?
Yeah, the collision was huge. They held on from there. As I mentioned earlier, they have not allowed a goal outside of that penalty. How about the goalie was a walk-on at Fairfield University?
Oh, that's the Stags. They opened the 1987 NCAA tournament against Indiana and lost 92-58 on March 15th of 1987 at the RCA Dome.
How the hell do you know that score?
Do you want to look that up? You want to look that up?
The 87 tournament. I'll take your word for it, you dope.
What, you don't believe me?
No.
Undrafted by the MLS. That's a pretty cool story.
That is.
Matt Turner in goal for the U.S. So again, 10 a.m., it'll be the U.S. and Netherlands. England won Group B. They've got Senegal. It's pretty cool to see Senegal.
I've always rooted for, aside from the United States, admittedly, in tournaments like this, if a country has the perception, and I don't know the socioeconomics of every country in the world, but if there's the perception that they come from a second or third world situation, I always pull for those countries, the underdog types.
Yeah, and Senegal would be one. I like seeing some variety. Like, I don't want to see in the final 16, 10 European countries.
Correct.
I love the variety of it. And so far, I guess we got a little bit of that. Guest-wise on the show today, Stephen Holder going to join us at 8 o'clock. Jake, it's the first time we've talked to Stephen since he chatted with Jim Irsay. I believe that was Thanksgiving.
I think that's right. Yep.
That's got to be. Boy, nothing like, hey, just sitting down to break bread and Jim Irsay's dialing you up. So we'll chat with Stephen about that. Tom Dienhart covers Purdue football for on3.com, joins us at 8:30. We'll get the lowdown on Purdue and Michigan. You know, split divisions obviously leads to this. I think I saw yesterday, Jake, this is only the second meeting between Purdue and Michigan in a decade.
Really?
I thought 2017 was the only other time.
Now, my friend Sheila DeMars and her sister Megan, my friend Sheila DeMars, who's like a lifelong friend of mine, her sister Chris, Sheila and Chris both went to Michigan, and then her other sister Megan and her brother Rick both went to Purdue. So you got two from Purdue and two from Michigan.
House divided.
House divided, baby.
Are they flying the flag?
They've got, actually, if you go by, you think it's night because they have PM flags flying all the time right there on the front porch. Kevin's looking at Mark. He's awaiting reaction. And Mark asleep at the wheel.
I'm just in disbelief that we've already gotten to this point at 7:23 in the morning.
This has been one of the more out there opening segments.
It's been a very versatile segment. What do you mean out there? I'm wide awake.
Apparently, some of the people who heard the police sirens, they all pulled over when I played it.
I mean, that was a little get off my lawn there. Worried about the high school or the college age kids sleeping outside. Jake, I'm going to go out on a limb and say they'll probably do some things in college that are a little bit more risky than sleeping outside.
Yeah, and grab a friend.
I get that, but do you trust the judgment of a college kid when it's like 10 degrees out and all they have is a sleeping bag?
What's it going to break into?
Again, I don't think they're like life is at risk. Don't get me wrong. I just think from Indiana's standpoint, it's like, really? You're going to make kids do that? I mean, come on.
You want to share my tent?
they're not allowing the tents.
You want to share the sleeping bag with me?
you want a pork chop?
So we can go to the basketball game.
Woo! Play a little Jeff Saturday audio here coming up. He did show some regret yesterday over the time management. And honestly, I think a little bit more game management than time management. We can get into that in closing out that Monday nighter. The spread for Sunday night continues to grow. Last I saw was at 11. Dallas favored over Indianapolis. Again, a chilly start to this Tuesday morning or Wednesday morning here in Indianapolis. Kevin Bowen, Jake Query, Mark Dykton. Kevin and Query, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
He'll be better for it next time. Us as players, it moves slower. It feels different to us when we're out on the field. We feel like we got it. We can run three plays in 10 seconds.
If you're talking about it.
People upstairs, they're moving at a different pace.
We're talking about it.
And everybody's like chaotic. So this is the first opportunity that he had to do something like this. Do I think it'll happen again in the future? No.
Your home for Indy sports. 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Hurry and grab the number one brand doctors trust for cough and cold. Buy Mucinex DM to get cough and chest congestion relief for three times longer than four-hour cough and congestion medicines. 12-hour relief is on its way. Use as directed.
It's the Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes & Sons Restoration. Make your game day experience the best it can be. Log on and get your tickets now. It's BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Making Moves is brought to you by LinkedIn Jobs.
In winning teams, every player brings their unique strength and has an impact on the results. The Dallas Mavericks drafted Jason Kidd with the second pick in the 1995 draft. But after 2.5 seasons, they traded him to Phoenix, and he then played for the Nets. It was not until he was 34 when he became a Maverick once again. He was exactly what they needed and became an integral part of a team that went on to win the 2011 NBA Finals over the Miami Heat.
Build your winning team today. Go to LinkedIn.com/sports.
If your team needed a point guard, you wouldn't waste your time interviewing centers and forwards, right? Well, the same is true for your business. LinkedIn Jobs taps into a network of over 850 million professionals to find the right people for your role. LinkedIn Jobs helps you narrow down to the most qualified candidates so you can start hiring the right people. Go to linkedin.com/sports to post your job for free. That's linkedin.com/sports. Terms and conditions apply.
On Wednesday, November 30th,
the hottest ticket in town,
AEW makes the return to the Indiana Farmers Coliseum at the Indiana State Fairgrounds for its only live show of the year. AEW Dynamite and AEW Rampage promise to be one of the biggest events of the year. Don't miss Kenny Omega, The Young Bucks, MJF.
I'm a generational talent.
Saraya.
I am the revolution.
Jon Moxley.
Get in the ring with me. It's dangerous as all hell.
Ryan Danielson. Claudio Castagnoli. Dr. Britt Baker, DMD. Jamie Hayter. Eddie Kingston. Orange Cassidy. The Acclaimed.
Everyone love The Acclaimed.
Swerve in Our Glory. Jade, FTR.
Top guys out.
Tony Storm. Wardlow. Chris Jericho. And the Jericho Appreciation Society.
And that's entertainment.
Darby Allin. Sting. And many more will be there live.
Oh!
Don't miss AEW Live at the Indiana Farmers Coliseum. Tickets make a great holiday gift and are on sale right now. Go to AEWTIX.com now. Card subject to change.
Miss Black Friday? Dell's Cyber Monday event starts now with deals on powerful business tech. The savings start now with up to 50% off business PCs powered by 12th Gen Intel Core processors. Don't forget special pricing on the latest monitors, docks, and accessories, plus free shipping on everything and special financing with Dell Business Credit. Call a Dell Technologies advisor at 877-ASK-DELL for Cyber Monday deals. That's 877-ASK-DELL, 877-ASK-DELL.
This week on RVER, sponsored by Progressive Insurance.
Oh, that new doctor is drop-dead gorgeous.
Oh, please, he's just another RV League-educated surgeon with good hair.
No, he's different.
Nurses, we got a Class C motorhome with a detached driver's side mirror. Meet me in the OR. Stat.
Right away, doctor.
No, she's on break. I'll handle this one.
Oh, you conniving little...
When your RV really needs saving, Progressive has you covered. See if you could save with a leader in RV insurance. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Covered subject to policy terms.
This week at all 26 Payless liquor stores, get Jim Beam's 12 Days of Whiskey for only $7.99. Sterling's 12 Days of Cocktails are only $34.99. Payless also has Chloe Chardonnay and Pinot Grigio for $9.99 a bottle, and Coppola Diamond Chardonnay is also $9.99. Plus Old Forester 86 and the 1.75 liter is just $31.99, and Bud Light and Coors Light 16-ounce 12-packs are $13.99. And don't forget, December the 10th is Payless Liquor's huge holiday event from 11 to 2 at the E Street location. Don't pay more, get more, and pay less at Payless Liquors.
Helzberg Diamonds presents The Guy Who Did His Homework. When it came to Jill's engagement ring, Brady knew exactly what to get.
Okay, so I came up with a design and showed it to all of our friends.
She'll love it!
Then he went to Helzberg. Their incredible selection of high-quality, lab-grown and natural diamonds made creating that special ring easy. Her reaction?
I love it! Can't wait to tell everybody!
Everybody might know about it.
Be like Brady. Create the ring of your dreams at a Helzberg near you or at Helzberg.com. Ask now about special financing offers.
Denny Smith here for Sundown Gardens. Don't let the holiday season pass without a trip to Sundown Gardens. A lot of Christmas decorations still on display at Miss Mary's Gift Shop, and they're 20% off daily. That's 20% off. Come to Sundown Gardens to get your live garland or porch greenery decor, too. Sundown Gardens really appreciates your business in 2022, and it's very excited about what's coming in 2023. Sundown Gardens at 186th Street and Spring Mill Road. SundownGardens.com. That's SundownGardens.com.
At Progressive, you can get 24/7 protection, even if you break the space-time continuum.
We did it. We time-traveled to yesterday.
Wait, Progressive covers us 24/7, but we just created an 8-day week, and it's 24/7 coverage, not 24/8. We gotta go back.
Are you joking right now?
Shh, I'm calling them. Hi, I have a question about time travel.
Progressive offers more than a great price when you bundle home and auto. We offer round-the-clock protection, which literally means anytime. Coverage from Progressive Casualty Insurance Company affiliates and third-party insurers and subject to policy terms. Bundle discount not available in all states or situations.
The Morning Checkdown, brought to you by Ball State Basketball. Get your tickets at ballstatesports.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Yeah, we'll get to college basketball in just a second, but we'll begin with the association. Tonight, Pacers and Sacramento Kings. Sacramento coming in having lost three straight. Indiana, of course, coming off their win against the Lakers. Tip off 10 o'clock. I always love, Kevin, the late night West Coast games. And there's just something fun about like staying up late, watching the games. I realize now we have a little bit different schedule, but
the only bummer for me is we've got Notre Dame at 9:15, Indiana at 9:15, and then the Pacers at 10. That's a lot to juggle.
Well, is there juggling for you?
No, it's Notre Dame basketball through and through.
Knicks 140-110 over Detroit last night. Julius Randle, leading scorer in that game. Dallas 116-113 over Golden State. It was the Clippers 118-112.
Yeah, fun storylines tonight with the Pacers and Kings. Halliburton and Hield back there, Sabonis and Turner. It does seem like that trade has a win-win feel to it with how both those teams needed to kind of move forward with their respective rebuilds. All right, college basketball tonight. Let's begin. Butler at hosting Kansas State. That's undefeated Kansas State. Butler's actually a slight favorite in that one over at Hinkle. That's an early tip. I think it's 6:30. You've got Purdue at Florida State. Last I saw, that line was -15.5 for the Boilermakers. It just shows you how bad Florida State is.
How does that happen? I mean, are they just young again because they went through a period where they had solid...
I just felt like they always reloaded under Leonard Hamilton. So Purdue looking for a road win tonight. And then Indiana and North Carolina, that is at 9:15. Again, the health and just kind of the stamina of North Carolina will be something to keep an eye on tonight. I think that line has dropped a little bit, which I'm curious about. I saw this morning IU favored by just 4.5. I would definitely take IU in that one. Because, Jake, I think one of these questions we have about North Carolina, did they just get hot for 3 weeks last year?
I think that's entirely possible, yes.
Remember, because they were like a bubble team in mid-February.
I mean, what were they seeded in the tournament last year?
They
like
were
a six?
Well, no, I think they beat Baylor from that 8-9 game. I think Baylor was the one, and they were one of the 8-9 seeds.
Really? They were that far down? Okay.
Again, they just got hot kind of late in the year to make the tournament. And again, we'll see about the health of Armando Bacot, their All-American big guy. He was
a big part of why they got why they were hot, right?
Yeah, he was limping in their 4 overtime loss to Alabama out in Portland.
College football playoff, no surprise in the top 4. Georgia, Michigan, TCU, and USC. Little bit of a surprise was there for you, Kevin, that Ohio State still lurks as the 5 seed and certainly is right there to step in should anybody stub their toe. Question, I guess, becomes, if TCU were to lose in the Big 12 championship game,
I don't think they fall.
You think they stay in?
Well, they're playing Kansas State. Kansas State's ranked 10th.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So it's not going to be a bad loss. USC would be the one.
So USC.
And that's Friday night, USC and Utah.
Utah's 11th.
No, I guess that's not very much of a difference. But they've already lost to Utah once.
That's a good point. They have one loss.
It's just wild, Jake, that, and again, we brought this up earlier in the week, 1, 2, 3, and 4 all play this weekend. 5, 6, 7, and 8, none of them play.
It does seem like it would be hard to be penalized for losing a conference championship game when the team that is replacing you is just sitting idle because they didn't make their conference title game.
Ohio State, Bama, Tennessee, Penn State. That is...
I mean, Ohio State has this going for it.
five, six, seven.
Penn State is ranked 8th. Notre Dame is ranked 21st. So those are two quality wins, right? I mean, 8th in particular, you know, Penn State. There was one other team I think they beat. Maybe that's it. Do they just have the two ranked team wins? All right, that's.
I'm a little confused how Clemson is still 9.
In terms of what? I think partially because.
Is South Carolina.
South Carolina is 19th.
Got it. Okay.
And they went from unranked to debuting at 19th. I think that helped them a little bit. I
mean, there's a chance. Again, we get through Friday night, USC wins, and we could be done. You know, Georgia, LSU, Michigan, Purdue, and TCU, Kansas State, the three championship games on Saturday, even if any of those teams lose, they could still be in the playoffs. So I think it's just a bit of an anticlimactic championship weekend based off what we've been used to in years past. All right, we'll get in some Colts conversation coming up in the 7, I guess a little bit later than the 7:30 segment. Again, Stephen Holder at 8. We'll chat Purdue and Michigan this Saturday night at Lucas Oil Stadium with Tom Dienhart at 8:30. Kevin Aquari on a Wednesday.
It's a championship triple header on American Standards College Football Saturday. The coverage begins at 11 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
At Shane Company, we know that love and meaning can be captured in a beautiful piece of fine jewelry. That's why we offer so many options to make your holiday gift even more personal. Jewelry with a birthstone makes a wonderful gift because it holds so much significance. Shane Company has unique styles with birthstones for every month of the year. Diamonds, cultured pearls, rubies, opals, and more. Why not create a necklace with her birthstone and then add a charm for good luck? A necklace with the first letter of her name lets her know how important she is to you. And our gold letter charms sparkle with diamond accents. Or select an engravable style. Give your loved one a bracelet inscribed with the place you met so they'll never forget that moment. Or capture your strong connection with a promise ring inscribed with both of your initials. Our jewelry consultants will make it easy. At Shane Company, we give you so many ways to create gifts infused with meaning. Treasures they'll have forever.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business. Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
This view was worth a hike.
Right? And it's a good way to stay on top of my health.
Yes, I'm Cologuard, a prescription colon cancer screening option for people 45 plus at average risk. Have you screened for colon cancer?
Not yet.
Don't wait. It's more treatable when caught in early stages.
Tell me more.
Cologuard is non-invasive and it's used at home. It detects altered DNA in your stool to find 92% of colon cancers.
92%?
Yep, even those in early stages.
This was seen in a clinical study with patients 50 and older. Any positive result should be followed by a diagnostic colonoscopy. False positive and negative results may occur. Cologuard is not a replacement for colonoscopy in high-risk patients. Do not use if you have had adenomas, have inflammatory bowel disease and certain hereditary syndromes, or a personal or family history of colon cancer.
Most insured patients pay $0. Ask your provider or an online prescriber if Cologuard is right for you, or visit Cologuard.com.
I'm in.
Are you suffering from chronic joint pain like Heather?
I have terrible arthritis and have had it for quite a while. And I've gone to all kinds of doctors trying to figure out what to do. And everybody just said surgery. And surgery was months of rehab. And I didn't want to do that.
But then Heather discovered QC Kinetics, local medical professionals who specialize in natural biologic treatments, non-invasive solutions designed to repair and restore damaged tissue in your joints. And she absolutely loves the results.
I like to tell anybody who's suffering that there are options that are not steroids, that are not surgery. You owe it to yourself to find out about QC Kinetics and find out what they can do for you.
No surgery, no drugs, no downtime. Discover QC Kinetics and learn more about natural biologic treatments with lasting results.
Call QC Kinetics 317-559-PAIN. That's 317-559-PAIN. 317-559-PAIN.
Ladies and gentlemen, please. 40, love, match point.
Out.
There's no way that was out.
Out. The ball is out. It's out.
Are you even watching?
No, honestly, I'm not. I'm watching college football on my phone with AT&T 5G.
Wow, that's too much.
With AT&T 5G, too much college football is never too much. 5G requires compatible plan and device. 5G may not be available in your area. See att.com/5G for you for details.
CSX Transportation is an industry leader on the move. The railroad company has immediate openings for freight train conductors. Join the CSX team and start your paid on-the-job training today, earning nearly $25 per hour with no degree required. If you're safety-focused with a passion for great service, you've got what it takes to move your career forward at CSX. Apply at csx.com/careers. That's csx.com/careers. CSX is an equal opportunity employer.
Do you work in the performance automotive or racing industry? I'm Kevin Lee, reminding you not to miss the three biggest business days in motorsports. Next week, December 8th through 10th, is the PRI Trade Show in Indianapolis. Connect with over 1,000 motorsports exhibitors eager to showcase their latest products, solutions, and more. Register in advance at PRI2022.com/attend and pick up your badge on site at the Indiana Convention Center. Register today at PRI2022.com/attend for the PRI Trade Show. See you there.
Hey, it's Big Joe for your trusted local independent American Standard Heating and Air Conditioning dealer, Kirby Heating and Air Conditioning. The Kirbys have been in business for nearly four decades, and son Robert says his parents' business practices won't ever change.
I love the way that they've ran the business, treat the customer right. Word of mouth is our biggest advertisement, so you treat people right, and they're going to recommend you 10 times more, so it's been great.
Call Jessica, Lloyd, Robert, and Adam at Kirby Heating and Air Conditioning at 317-892-3614. Kirby is your trusted local independent American Standard dealer.
A new season, a new QB, a new look. Football is back. And so are Bud Light Blue Mondays. Join JMV Mondays at Buffalo Wild Wings for ice cold Bud Lights, Colts football talk, and your chance to win tickets to Colts games. This week, stop by and see JMV at Buffalo Wild Wings in Greenfield. JMV, Bud Light, and you. Doing it for the shoe. Bud Light Blue Mondays.
Tickets on sale now for Christmas Nights of Lights at the Indiana State Fairgrounds. Purchase online early to reserve your time slot. Reservations are required. Christmas Nights of Lights is brighter than ever this season, as they have added several new light displays to their show of over 2 miles of driving route. They're excited to reveal one of their most creative and colorful light displays, the Field of Lights. Christmas Nights of Lights is open nightly, all holidays, rain or shine, November 11th through January 1st. They are reservations only, so purchase tickets at ChristmasNightsOfLights.com.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
You know the name of this band, Kevin? Somewhat Colts related?
Yeah, I should. I definitely know the song.
This is a great song, by the way. It's one of those songs you don't want people to know you like, but it's...
Oh, really?
Pretty catchy song.
I'd raise my hand.
He'll be playing tonight.
Colts related?
Kind of. Would you agree, Mark?
Yeah. Yeah. I see what you're doing there. Yeah.
At the time it came out, I guess.
Let's hear it.
Baltimora is the name of the band. Mm-hmm. By the way, speaking of the Colts, looking back and looking forward, we'll begin with the looking forward aspect of it. Kevin, you had mentioned this yesterday, so credit to you in terms of planting this seed. I did talk yesterday with one of the organizers for 100 Black Men, which is an organization I've been a part of, which helps out with mentoring young students at IPS schools, really throughout the city, not just IPS schools, but inside of schools throughout the city of Indianapolis through the United Way, and talked to the director of it yesterday. If you have tickets for the Colts' final home game against the Houston Texans, which is slated for January 8th, maybe moved to the 7th, but most likely is going to be a 1 o'clock kick on January 8th, if you've decided that due to coming off, you know, for whatever reason, if you can't go to that game, if you forward the tickets to me, which is Jake at 1075thefan.com, the radio station you're listening to, Jake at 1075thefan.com, I've gotten in touch with the folks at 100 Black Men in the United Way, where we will then facilitate those tickets to be able to go to mentees and their mentors that wouldn't normally get a chance to go to an NFL game, and they will be on their way to Lucas Oil Stadium.
Love
so
it. Love
we have until
that.
January 3rd to forward me those tickets. But in terms of, as I'd mentioned, that game might be on a Saturday or a Sunday. But in terms of looking back to Monday, Jeff Saturday had conversation about regrets that he might have had about what happened on Monday, right?
Yeah, the time management late in the game. And, you know, I think a lot was made about it late Monday night. We talked about it a little bit yesterday. My issue with not taking those timeouts there was maybe less to do with the clock. I mean, I still think there were some clock implications. I probably had more game management questions of, in such a chaotic time, with two rookies out on the field, with a running back that's not used to playing in the two-minute packages, a play caller that is extremely young in this situation, a timeout, yeah, it stops the clock, but it also lets you to kind of regroup and get everybody on the same page. And if you listen to Alex Highsmith, the guy that made the big play on third down for Pittsburgh after the game, he made it very clear that he knew right away, based off where Jelani Woods was lining up and Jonathan Taylor was lining up on that third down, he knew it was going to be an inside run. And he blew that play up. So that, to me, is more of a game management thing of, again, you get everybody to your sideline and everybody's on the same page. You know, maybe you make a substitution there. Maybe it's Mo Alley Cox in the game as a better blocker than Jelani Woods in that situation. Jeff Saturday pointed out yesterday that it was a little bit of a disarray situation looking back on it. And if he had to do it over again, he would have taken a timeout. This is after the Matt Ryan scramble before the third and three that Taylor got stuffed on and the fourth down was incomplete. Here was Jeff Saturday yesterday on one end, another crack at that.
I wish I had that third down back. In all honesty, I wish I'd have used a timeout. Just looking at it on film, looked at it last night again, looked at it this morning again, and from a time perspective, I felt good, but you could tell we were in disarray. I just didn't have a great feel, and Parks made a great call. I still liked the call right away. You know, I told him to have one ready, and as soon as he went down, he had the call in place. So his was on, but then we had the formation and personnel. We had guys running across. And again, I just, you know, looking back, it's a learning experience.
Definitely is that. You know, Jake, when I think back to the Jim Caldwell era here in Indianapolis, for you, what do you think fans most remember about his tenure here?
Honestly, the starters being taken off the field against the Jets.
Which was not his decision, correct?
Correct. No question.
Yeah, I guess Caldwell-related decisions, certainly the Super Bowl, and just everything happened there to start the second half and the onside kick. But the other thing was, think back to Peyton Manning's last game here. Colts-Jets, wild card round of the playoffs, 2010 season. Caldwell takes a timeout late in that game that allows the Jets one more crack.
I remember that. Yep.
At it downfield. Mark Sanchez to Braylon Edwards. They get in. Was it Nick Folk? I think it's still kicking. They get into much more manageable field goal range. They kick the game winner at the buzzer. Like, these sorts of scenarios, the time management, when you call a timeout, when you don't, how you react to the final minute, final 30 seconds. There's too much parity in this league to screw that up. Jeff Saturday's in his third game as a head coach, so I'm not going to roast him for that, but it is a reminder, and it's kind of why, well, certainly why I laughed at the Jim Irsay. Oh yeah, I like him, that he doesn't have any experience, he doesn't have any fear. Well, these situations matter a whole lot, and you cannot have those mistakes, or else it puts your team at a disadvantage when these games come down to a 3 points here, a 4 points there, a field goal late, extra timeout late, all those things. Look at Buffalo, Kansas City in the playoff game last year and how timeouts were handled. And that one, it matters a ton.
Do you think there is a difference between the way that you see and feel and react to the pace of a football game when you're on the field and you're in the midst of it as opposed to outside of it? In other words, are there things that Jeff Saturday, the center, would have noticed or instinctively reacted towards in terms of an adjustment or a formation to call out that he does not notice being from the sidelines and being further removed outside of it?
Definitely. I would argue, Jake, you react differently if you're up in the booth versus the sideline.
Right.
You know, Parks Frazier wants to be up in the booth calling the plays. Frank Reich, you know, obviously he's the head coach, wanted to be on the sideline. So that, you know, is a big difference. Gus Bradley is on the sideline. I think you have some coordinators that would rather be up in the booth. And I know Jeff had people in his ear, you know, suggesting, offering advice on what to do in that situation with that play. This is a little bit of a, I don't know even how many scenarios have unfolded in the NFL this way, but this was from NFL research yesterday. The Colts are the only team this season to have timeouts unused when driving for a potential tying touchdown in the final 35 seconds when they were inside the opponent's 40.
You know what I'd like to invent, and if I invent it...
I think they had two timeouts left, if I'm not mistaken.
What I'm going to invent and patent and trademark, and then I'll give you guys a little bit of love. I mean, if you want to go on a vacation or something with the money, I mean, I'll retire. But the coaches, when they wear the headset, you're talking about Jeff Saturday getting cues from Parks Frazier or talking back and forth, right? And they have the headset, and then what do they invariably do? What does every coach do when they're talking into the headset, Kevin?
Do they cover their mouth?
Yes. They usually, with their play sheet, cover their mouth so you can't see what they're saying. I'd like to invent and the Motorola folk, if they're listening, you know, I mean, just give me credit and then royalties. Why do they not invent the mouthpiece that has the little microphone on it with a shield over it, so that when you slide it over, it just covers, like your hand does, covers that part of your mouth and you can't see the mouth. That way you're playbook free, your hands free.
Do we have that already with COVID?
Well, they had, that's the other thing, is like when they were all wearing the masks due to COVID, I'm like, okay, the lips are covered. Like if it's that important to cover so that nobody can read what they're saying. Baseball pitchers do it too, right? When the catcher comes out, the pitcher uses his mitt to cover himself up.
Yeah.
So that you can't read lips. I mean, I don't know if they all like have like the Marley Matten or whatever her name was when she was on Seinfeld that can read lips from far away. I mean, I'm not a lip reader, but apparently people are. But wouldn't it behoove them to just have a Motorola headset that when you slide it over, comes the microphone is behind a small placard that covers your mouth? These are the kinds of things I think about late at night.
Sounds like a patent that would go absolutely nowhere.
Oh, I disagree. I mean, I think it's kind of like if you were to invent something that you put on your eyeglasses that prevents them from slipping down your nose.
Rex goes as John Fox on Saturday's headset during the game. John Fox, I think, primarily defensive-wise, is helping out that side of the ball. I think this is more of specific timeout. You know, I know the word analytics people freak out about, but a little bit more of that, of them chiming in, hey, you know, if we get X amount of yards here, I think we should take a timeout. Very time-specific. I don't think that was necessarily John Fox in that moment.
Now, can you also have, like, John Fox being a guy that has head coaching experience, and this is kind of reiterating what you're just saying, but like, do you think those guys stay totally in their lane, or is their mic open at all times to be able to, regardless of whether it's an area of their designed expertise? Does that make sense what I'm saying?
Yeah, I think it'd be fascinating to have a team kind of show behind the scenes what happens on a headset during a game. How many people is Jeff Saturday talking to during a game?
Yeah.
And yeah, to your point, where are the open lines of communication? How much back and forth is there? All of that dialogue, I think, would be fascinating. So Jeff Saturday would like to have that one back from Monday. We'll chat with Stephen Holder here in a few minutes. Got this from John, Jake. I don't know if I totally follow it. John goes, let's not get too overconfident in the Pacers this year. Great fun to watch and are moving in the right direction, but for this season, please note it's a young team, several rookies. This is a long season. There will be a wall at some point for some of the younger guys. I don't speak for everyone, but I don't think anyone, or at least I am not, acting like the Pacers starting 12-8 means they're going to be a 4 seed in the playoffs and they're going to host an opening round playoff series. Water will find its level. The Pacers don't have a lot of, you know, high-level depth. If Halliburton went down tomorrow, they'd be scrambling for the rest of the season.
Right.
And trying to replace an all-star caliber player. But I look at it as, put the record aside. You've got young pieces coming together, offering hope, making winning plays late. I mean, that was LeBron, Anthony Davis, Russell Westbrook.
You're
on
right.
The other end of the floor, and that was Nemhard, Mathurin, Halliburton.
Are they too young at this point to even know they're not supposed to be there?
There's probably some of that. But remember last year, Jake? I know these same guys necessarily weren't there, Nemhard, Mathurin, obviously. How bad they were late games last year?
Yeah.
So it's growth. And all of this, to me, is a puzzle piece. Big puzzle that you're putting together. And you have legitimate pieces. Halliburton and Mathurin being the biggest ones. You still need to probably go find another big piece. But those two are unquestioned pieces. And
I
then
think
look
you
at
said,
the complimentary pieces.
I think you said yesterday very well, Kevin, their missing piece is a long wing defender, right?
Yeah, 6'8", 6'9".
Yep. By the way, hey, Jake, my student who's, or my child who is a sophomore is already in line for students, or for student tickets at Indiana. He's been camping out all day. Things officially open at 4 o'clock. They're allowed to have blankets and sleeping bags. They've been camping out overnight and will wait in line until 4 o'clock today when the arena opens.
Let's go. I mean, didn't we have the IU kids?
You're right.
Kids?
It was. Fortunately, it was warm last night.
Didn't we have the IU kids at a football game? Was it this year, last year, they just, hundreds of them, I don't know about hundreds, probably more like 60, just took their shirts off in freezing weather, and that was like the highlight of the game. ESPN just decided to show them instead of the product on the field.
Yeah, up in the upper left, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Hey, man, you're right. College, that's what it's all about, right?
College. And furthermore, to the Pacers' point, you still have the 3 first-round picks next year. Buddy Hield and Miles Turner are these interesting case studies and what you do with them the rest of the season. So, yes, John, I at least am not acting like the Pacers are going to be a 4 seed come April. But that, to me, doesn't really matter. What matters more is you are getting actual, tangible, young evidence of, wow, this rebuild has started and has some very intriguing pieces with more to come moving forward.
That's the thing, man.
Very exciting.
That's the thing. More to come, right?
The whole hope, Jake. We talked about it with the Colts. The Colts right now don't have very much hope. The Pacers have legit, legit hope. And that's exciting if you're a fan. Gotta be.
Stephen Holder going to join us, Mark?
Yes, that's the plan.
Where have you been, Mark, by the way? Are you here this morning?
Did you
take the day off again?
No. Do I sound like I have?
Mark's gutting it out.
I'm congested. That's all I am.
You are. Do you need some hot tea? Do you need a hotty toddy?
Did you see? I brought in some tea.
That's tea?
Yeah, I put some tea in here this morning. The Cristinary, which I don't know, it's not the Cristinary special, but some tea and some honey. He said also some whiskey would work. I decided to forego the whiskey in there. But
are you
yeah.
stopped up also?
I just feel like my voice is like 82%.
82. Mark, what's yours? You're at about 55, right?
Yeah, I'm a failing grade at the moment. I know it would help, though.
Pretty good, but I'm running out of beer, which is a problem. And weed. But that was my own fault. I should have stocked up ahead of time, honestly.
Now, is that live outside of Assembly Hall right now with those students?
Probably. A couple beer
right.
bongs hanging out, yeah.
Stephen Holder, next.
It was a blunder, man. I mean, when Matt Ryan got sacked, 30 seconds came off the clock before they ran the run play. So that's a blunder. Like, that's a legit blunder.
If you're talking about it.
But we're seeing, you know, a first-time head coach.
We're talking about it.
It was mismanaged. Like, let's just call it for what it is. Two things can be true at the same time. I always say that. He can be our boy. We can also be critical of how he handles things down the stretch. It was a blunder, man.
Your home for Indy sports. 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Right now, buy 4 Ultimate washes and get 2 free, available online or at any crew car wash location. Plus, get a free bonus wash now through November 30th.
Denny Smith for Sundown Gardens. Lots of Christmas decorations still on display at Miss Mary's Gift Shop. 20% off daily, 186th Street and Spring Mill Road, sundowngardens.com.
Guys, listen up. If you're suffering from hair loss, then you got to check out Bosley. Bosley offers the most advanced technology to restore your hair. All it takes is a simple one-day procedure to get your hair back. Plus, Bosley can help you keep the hair you have and grow more hair where you need it most. There is no comparison when it comes to hair restoration. Bosley is literally America's most experienced hair restoration experts. And believe me, you want to go to the experts. The doctors at Bosley have done the most procedures using the latest technology, and experience matters. Best of all, Bosley's permanent solution is backed by Bosley's guarantee. It's a no-brainer. When it comes to restoring your hair, you want to go with the name America trusts. That's Bosley. Check them out today. Get a free information kit and gift card for $250 off when you text WIN to 203-203. That's WIN to 203-203. Don't wait. Take action now and get your hair back. Text WIN to 203-203.
Hey, it's Mark from Kevin and Query. And Colts fans, now's the perfect time to download FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook, because right now, new customers get a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. That's free bets back if your first bet doesn't win. All you have to do is download the FanDuel Sportsbook app and sign up with promo code MARK, FanDuel is everything from the money line to point spreads to player props. You can combine your bets for a chance at a bigger payout with the same game parlay. With live betting, you'll get updated odds on games that have already started. And when you win, you get paid fast on an app that's safe, secure, and easy to use. They also have everyday odds, boosts, and specials. They had a no-sweat same game parlay for NBA games last night that I hit. That was pretty nice. That was a nice way to start the week. So sign up today with promo code MARK for your no-sweat first bet. All you have to do is sign up with promo code MARK, M-A-R-C, when you download the app. Make every moment more this season with FanDuel, official sportsbook partner of the Indianapolis Colts. 21 and over and present in Indiana. First online real money wager only. Refund issued is now withdrawable free bets that expire in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Need assistance with door and window projects? The Home Depot can help. From inspiration and materials to ordering and installation, our free Millwork virtual apron service can get you moving and doing. Plus, we speak Spanish too. Our associates can help you tackle complex jobs without you leaving the job site, saving you time and money. Call us at 1-833-HD-APRON or visit homedepot.com/MVA. The Home Depot, how doers get more done.
Okay, smile naturally. Perfect.
Cam's Photography knows wedding season ramps up in a flash. They need to say I do to a studio assistant before clients go full bridezilla.
I'm so sorry. I have to get a different lens. I'll be right back.
Indeed can help them hire great people fast.
I need Indeed.
Indeed you do. We instantly connect you with quality candidates whose resumes on Indeed match your job description. Visit Indeed.com/credit and get $75 towards your first sponsored job. Terms and conditions apply.
Start a new career with a job that keeps your community safe. The Marion County Sheriff. Carrie Forrestal is hiring detention deputies to work in the brand new Community Justice Center. You'll supervise and guard offenders, making Marion County a better place to live. Starting pay begins at around $40,000 a year with a $5,000 signing bonus. Enjoy great benefits like complete health coverage and pension plan. Start your career as a detention deputy and earn the respect of your community. Apply today at joinmcso.indy.gov.
Helzberg Diamonds presents the guy who was the MVP. Craig was proposing to his girlfriend and needed the perfect ring, so he asked her friends for some advice.
Get yourself to Helzberg.
Yep, Craig went to Helzberg Diamonds. He learned that Helzberg's been in business for over 100 years. That means quality. And with their price match guarantee, he'd get a great deal and find the perfect ring.
Wow, it's perfect.
Oh, yeah.
MVP, most valuable proposer. Be like Craig. Find the ring of her dreams at a Helzberg Diamonds near you or at Helzberg.com.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly.
Don't risk getting stranded with a bad battery. Our professional parts people at O'Reilly Auto Parts will test your battery for free. If your battery does need to be replaced, we'll help you find the best battery for your vehicle and your budget. Don't wait until your battery is dead. Get it tested for free today at your local O'Reilly Auto Parts store.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
The Colts head to Dallas to face the Cowboys on Sunday Night Football. Free game on The Fan at 5:30 with the game on 97.1 Hank FM.
Listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Feels like longer than a week since we've chatted with our next guest. That would be Stephen Holder, who joins us every Wednesday here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Stephen, of course, with ESPN.com now. And Stephen, I'm sitting there Thanksgiving night and scrolling through Twitter because, yeah, to be honest with you, I think I was kind of done with the family. And all of a sudden,
okay.
I'm like, wait a minute, Jim Irsay and Stephen Holder are having conversations on Thanksgiving? Boy, that's got to be quite the, excuse me, I got to back away from the table here, and all of a sudden the big guy wants to chat. Well, how did that come about, and what were your big takeaways from that?
Oh, boy. Yeah, the reason it feels like more than a week since we've talked is because every week on the Colts beat is like a year, okay? That's the first thing. So, yeah, I'm minding my own business on Thanksgiving. And Jim Irsay, right now, he's in a place where, you know, he kind of, it seems, he feels the need to respond to things. You know, I think when when he initially made the Jeff Saturday hire, you know, Tony Dungy and some others had some statements that he didn't, or I guess took exception to, and, you know, he called a couple of our colleagues and had some thoughts that he expressed on that. And so this was one of those instances. I wasn't quite sure where he was going with it when he reached out. And as we began talking, well, first I said, well, you know, hey, so are we done with Thanksgiving or what here? You know, so apparently he had already had dinner. I had not, but whatever. I think this stems from the Nick Sirianni comments and some of the sentiments around it. But I just didn't think that required a response. But I think, you know, we in media, look, if someone of some stature has something to say, you know, look, we are the vehicle through which they can talk, and that's fine. So, yeah, I think he just wanted to set the record straight that he and Frank Reich, he was very fond of Frank Reich and had very, you know, had a very good relationship with Frank Reich. And I think I certainly didn't think otherwise. I believed that to be true. And I would say that I heard from Frank Reich. He read the story. He agreed with everything that Jim Irsay said, by the way, which was not something that I included in there because it happened later. So I think everybody's on the same page, except maybe Nick Sirianni. But look, Nick was talking emotionally, and it kind of is what it is.
So Jim mentions in that story that he gave – that Frank – approached him for the contract extension back last August, and the reason for that was Jim decided to give Frank an extension, which was not something he typically does with years left in the contract because of the closeness between the Irsay and Reich family.
So he basically was trying to establish that was part of his effort to establish that, like, hey, you know, I was good to Frank Reich, because he claims, and I would have to go do the research on this, but he claims that he's never given a coach an extension with 2 years remaining on his contract. Now, to be clear, to anyone who read the story and was confused about his statements, Jim had his dates mixed up. He kept saying that happened this year. Of course, I, knowing better, said, no, that happened in 2021. So anyway, he insisted repeatedly, so I went ahead and put what he said in there and then juxtapose that, you know, next to here's what the team announced, if that makes sense. So if that was confusing to anyone, that's what happened. But anyhow, to your point, he said, look, you know, he said Frank or Frank's agent, he said Frank raised the idea of a contract extension. I guess this would have been back in the summer of 2021. And, you know, he said he was initially resistant, but he did it because he felt, well, you know, maybe that would sort of strengthen his situation and give him a better foundation going forward. And he thought maybe it would be good in the long term. Ultimately, it didn't work out. But that's what Jim Irsay said happened. And yes, it is another example, he says, of him being very fond of Frank Reich, and that the firing being just basically a football decision and not about anything else.
Steven, Jim Irsay, to his credit, Stephen Holder's our guest on the Payless Liquors Hotline. He's with ESPN and ESPN.com. Jim Irsay, to his credit, has worked very hard and been very public about his work to avoid becoming the unpredictable owner that his father was. And there were a lot of issues that went into his father's unpredictability that, fortunately, I think Jim Irsay has worked very hard to avoid or shed. However, is Jim Irsay's competitive fire, not only for his football team, but for his own reputation in terms of his football acumen, beginning to bleed over to a detrimental point towards unpredictability of his franchise?
I think here's what we can say. We can say that his recent actions, from all indications, Jim Irsay's recent actions, be they right or wrong, and time will tell, his recent actions are certainly, I think, out of character. I think that's what we can say. And when I say out of character, I say that because he always makes his his opinion known. Okay, let's be clear about that. Like, if you work for Jim Irsay, you always know where Jim Irsay stands, okay, because he's going to tell you. That's a fact. But that doesn't mean he's going to necessarily dictate what happens and what you should do. Now, him expressing his opinion, I was told this by someone recently, and it's a good point. I was told by someone recently that, look, I mean, he does have this reputation for staying out of things, but he is very much known to express his opinions very firmly, and that does sort of influence actions by general managers, coaches, whoever, right? But I think that's also not what we're talking about here. Here, I think he's gone further than just influencing things. I think he clearly dictated some things. And then I think that's where there's a difference, you know? So, yeah, I think it's a departure from the past for Jim Irsay. And I think that's notable. And it's going to be interesting to see, you know, how that plays out in you know, what's to come. Because there is going to be a coaching search. And I think this is going to be a bigger coaching search than maybe previously thought. I'm starting to get that indication. Like, I think the shine is off Jeff Saturday a little bit here, you know, not just because of, you know, the situation Monday night. I just mean generally. I mean, look, it sounded good to Jim Irsay initially. I think it's pretty clear to most people that, you know, look, maybe we should think about this, right? Take a step back and think about whether this is a permanent, whether this should be a permanent move. I think the fan base, I think you'd have to really sell Jeff Saturday to the fan base in the long term, right, as a permanent hire. So I think this is going to be an open-ended coaching search. I'm starting to lean that way. So my point is, we'll see how Jim Irsay's recent actions, how they play out in the coaching search and other decisions to come.
Going off that point, again, Stephen Holder's with us from ESPN.com. The shine off, you are interpreting that a little bit more of the Colts are saying, all right, we need to sit back and really look into this, as opposed to Saturday himself looking at it and saying, you know, I don't really know if I want to do this on a permanent basis.
Yeah, I can't say where Jeff stands. Right. That's a good interpretation. Yeah. I don't know where Jeff stands. look, I think from a perception standpoint, I think this is probably in terms of how you're perceived, right? You know, because when you're the head coach, you know, you take a lot of bullets, right? And you take a lot of criticisms. I mean, look, that part's not fun, okay? And I mean, just how they played in the NFL for a long time, so it's not like he's soft about those things, you know. But it's a little different when you're the head coach versus being, you know, the starting center. I think that there's a big difference for sure. And the level of responsibility, right? For what happens, the wins, the losses, the decisions, all of that. So I don't know how that's affected him. I have no idea. I just know that that's something that's new for him. Right. And the job is also pretty hard. So I don't know. I don't know where Jeff stands on all this, but I do think that he will have a lot to think about, you know, in terms of whether he even wants the job. Right. I don't know that that's an open and shut case for him. I don't know. And I think I thought he was relatively clear about that when he got the job. I mean, he was eager to do it on the interim basis. I think he left me at least with the impression that, you know, he had no idea whether this was something that he wanted to do or should do in the long term. And I think from the Colts' perspective, I think that's also going to be the case. I think they're going to step back and take a look at this. And I've even heard that they're looking at various options out there. I don't know who they are, but I've heard that, you know, they have a list and that they are compiling a list of coaches to look at.
I think it's very smart, by the way. Good.
What's that?
Well, which I think it's very smart. I think you need to have an exhaustive.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Steven, you ever have one of those dreams where you're like in a hallway and every door is locked and you're like, you're in a maze, like one of those escape rooms? Like, have you ever had any sort of like epiphany like that? Am I the only one? Which is entirely possible.
You know, this is going to surprise you, but I can't say that I have. Okay. But I'm willing to hear this out, though. Let's go.
Do you feel like that right now? Okay, so, but you know, I mean, you get the imagery, right? Like, you have that dream, or like in a horror movie where somebody's in a hall and, you know, trying to get out, every door's locked.
That sounds terrible. Yeah.
It is. And I feel like that's, when I look at the Colts' future, that's what it feels like to me.
Yeah.
Every single avenue that I think of as being their outlet towards a sunny future moving forward has the doors locked. They don't have a quarterback for the future. They don't have a left tackle, theoretically, for the future. They don't have a field-stretching wide receiver for the future. They don't have a coach right now in the future. It's not certain they have a general manager in the future. Talk me off the ledge here.
No, I have to kind of agree. And I'm trying to articulate a quarterback story here. You know, there's so many moving parts to that whole thing. But that, as part of that, one of the things I've been thinking about is these last 3 years where they've gone with the veteran quarterback, they've done it in part because they didn't feel like the draft was a viable option for them, you know, to find a starter immediately. And that's fine. Whatever. We can criticize that. We can quibble, whatever. But also, there's another reason. The other reason they went with veterans is because they felt like we got a pretty good team here. And maybe we're just a quarterback away from taking another step. Not winning the Super Bowl, but a quarterback away from winning in the playoffs or whatever that case might be, right? I think most people would agree that had some influence on how they proceeded at quarterback. Now, think about that. This team is no longer just a quarterback away. This season has laid bare the reality, which is that they're not a quarterback away. And maybe they were never. Maybe they never were a quarterback away. You know, I think that's fair to ask now. And so it leaves you in a place kind of where you just described, you know, where are they? they arguably have more problems than actual solutions for the future. And I think that's really disturbing if you're a Colts fan. I'm not talking you off the ledge, I guess, is what I'm doing here, because I'm also not telling you to jump, but saying I get it. So look, I think one thing you didn't mention, and I'll add to your list, you know, their best defensive player, Shaquille Leonard, is a very muddy future right now, you know, and I think the strength of their team has been their offensive line. Doesn't feel like a strength of their team right now, and they've got a lot of money invested there. I mean, there's so many critical, fundamental issues and questions that need to be answered that I think the future for the Colts is very problematic in the short term. I mean, take the Steelers. I'm rambling now, but take the Steelers, right? So they draft this quarterback, Kenny Pickett, and, you know, they've had a lot of ups and downs this year. And so I think that shows you how the typical rookie quarterback goes, right? And he played well the other night at times, I thought. I actually think there's a lot of upside with Kenny Pickett. But I bring that up because it just goes to show you, if they go draft a quarterback, I'm all for that, but I'm just –
Right, you're stepping back 2 years, right?
Exactly. That's exactly.
But, Steven,
right.
So which leads to my other question, which is this. If you're Jeff Saturday, I guess my question, and this is where I just get confused when I, again, more doors are being locked to me in my hallway, because I think about Jeff Saturday and I'm like, okay, Saturday probably wants to win games right now because he wants to show that he can coach in the NFL and prove doubters wrong and whatever else. I get that. Chris Ballard probably wants to, at this point, start assessing players and figuring out who, you know, who we can keep around and whatever else. And maybe he's looking more towards the future. Boom. Two people, two different pages, theoretically. In addition to that, then I look at, like, does Jeff Saturday, in his mind, is he playing for, or is he coaching right now to be the coach? Or is he coaching as an assessment for a different area in which he's going to be with the organization? And how does Ballard feel about that? And are we back to Grigson Pagano, two guys? To me, the whole thing is just a huge mess, literally. Like, I feel like if you're driving on 56th Street, there's going to be a huge roadblock around Lafayette Road that says, warning, construction upcoming. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I think, not to mention all the potholes, right? So
yeah.
Look, so So listen, I agree with you there, and I do think that part of what they have right now, and it's temporary, so maybe it doesn't matter. But I think you just laid it out. Part of what they have right now is they don't really have a brain trust. You know, they have three people with maybe competing loyalties, goals, viewpoints. I don't know where that gets you. And the three people I'm talking about are Chris Ballard, Jeff Saturday, and Jim Irsay. Like, I don't know if any of those three guys are on the same page about anything. I don't know. I'm not saying they aren't. I'm saying I'm just not so sure that they are. And you laid out why that's probably the case. So it's not a great situation, I think. And I think that impacts what happens in the future and decisions that get made and where you focus, all of those things. Yeah, I agree. It's a problem.
Yeah, again, major questions at the pillars that Jim Irsay always talks about, head coach, GM, and quarterback. Yeah. And I don't think even in 2011, 2017, 98, you still knew Manning and Luck were either coming or they were there in the sense of still on your roster. Obviously, you don't have that right now. Steven, last one from me. And again, Steven Holder with us from ESPN.com. I thought Matt Ryan looked incredibly old the other night. I feel like his arm, I don't know. He just looked 37 to me. Why not Nick Foles? I mean, I'm not acting like it'd be some significant upgrade, but this passing offense can't do anything, especially can't do anything vertically. There's a financial component that you're running the risk of continuing to play Matt Ryan, and if he were to get hurt behind this offensive line, he'd be owed even more money for next season. It seems like they want to win now, even in this 4-7-1 current scenario. So I'd play Ehlinger, but again, that's just me. It doesn't seem like that's necessarily on the radar. Why don't you think Nick Foles is being thought of as a possible option?
That's a fair question. I haven't thought a lot about Foles, but I do think that's a fair question. I agree with what you said about Matt Ryan. I thought that his balls have lost some velocity.
And maybe it's a shoulder, Steven.
I wonder. Because I didn't think his throws looked this way earlier in the season. I just didn't. I'm not saying he was like 84 Dan Marino, okay? But I'm just saying, I think they definitely have lost some velocity, his throws. And there were times last night, even on the deep throws, the two or three that they had, the intermediate throws, really. The one to Jelani Woods, the ball takes a long time to get there, if you look at it. And it gets there, and it's accurate, right? He's still pretty accurate, but it takes a long time to get there. And I think some of those balls to the outside, the throws outside the numbers, if you notice, the Steelers were jumping those throws.
They contested so much.
Yeah, and I think you are onto something there, and that's probably very – I think there's a relationship there is what I'm saying. So anyway, to Foles, it's an interesting question. I guess part of it is they probably feel, and Jeff Saturday probably feels like Matt Ryan has been kind of yo-yoed a little bit this season, and he has. That's fair. Now, should that matter? I don't know. Maybe it shouldn't. But I guess what I'm saying is it's probably delicate, in how you proceed there, because you've already kind of had a train wreck in how they've handled the quarterback situation already. So I don't know. It'll be interesting to see if they stick with Matt Ryan. But I think Jeff Saturday was pretty clear about that the other night. We'll see if he sticks with that.
Steven, I hope you're laying on a couch here, because I'm going to ask one more totally Freudian question for you. Or actually, I guess I'm the one laying on the couch because I'm doing a psychoanalysis of myself. I have said on this show, I've said numerous places, I want to run a theory past you, and you, as a more dialed in and educated man than I, can critique it. A general manager in the National Football League, there is no player under which a general manager can find himself more attached at the hip than quarterback. And I'm, by that, I mean when they go out and they draft a quarterback. You can be a general manager for a long time, but you truly go on the clock once you select the quarterback that you are going to then build around. And part of me wonders if Chris Ballard has not avoided going the quarterback route in terms of moving up and selecting the franchise build around quarterback, because he knew that was the moment that the clock began and that all microscope then truly goes on the acumen of the general manager. and the time is now where all of a sudden the judgment day is here and he's not going to have a choice and he's got to do it. Your thoughts?
No, I think you actually are correct. And I guess if you're on the couch, I guess that means that I'm the therapist.
That's right.
I don't know if I'm qualified for that, but I would say this. I think Chris Ballard's statements, I don't have to psychoanalyze him because he said it. Okay, he has said it. He has said enough things and made enough statements that I think have led us to believe that he has been timid about the quarterback situation. There also haven't been like prime opportunities. Let's be clear, right? It's not like they've passed up a bunch of quarterbacks on their draft board. They haven't. They really, really haven't, right? So I want to be clear about that. I don't think we can like pound him for it, but I also think he has given us his outlook on this a number of times. And it's almost like I think Chris Ballard he wants the sure thing at quarterback. Here's the problem. There isn't one. Unless you're picking like first in the draft, there really isn't one. And so that's part of the problem. And that is, I think, one of the difficulties that Chris Ballard is going to have to get past if he's making the quarterback decision for this team next year. And I think you're absolutely right.
Can Stephen Holder, ESPN.com, if you missed it, head to his Twitter feed, chatted with Jim Irsay late last week. I know kind of get lost in the holiday shuffle, but a lot of stuff over on ESPN.com from Stephen. We'll see you later today over at West 56, Stephen.
All right, guys. See you soon.
That's Stephen Holder right there on the Payless Liquors hotline. Tom Dienhart to chat about Purdue and the Big Ten Championship coming up this Saturday night. He joins us here in a few minutes. Let's talk a little morning checkdown right now.
The Morning Checkdown, brought to you by Ball State Basketball. Get your tickets at ballstatesports.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Busy night in the association, but we will begin with one of the games that actually will end the evening. It's the Pacers in Sacramento, taking on the Kings. Sacramento coming in with a three-game losing skid, but they have played well since the trade that has brought Tyrese Haliburton here. Domas Sabonis, Kevin, you mentioned earlier, might be simply one of those trades that is a win-win in terms of freeing up players for both teams. But Pacers coming off that big win against the Lakers tonight, 10 o'clock in California's capital.
4.5-point favorite for the Kings. A lot of storylines, like you said. Haliburton healed, Keegan Murray, Benedict Mathurin, Sabonis Turner. Should be a fun one from Sacramento. College basketball tonight. It'll begin at Hinkle around 6:30. Butler's hosting undefeated Kansas State. Butler actually a slight favorite in that one, despite a big discrepancy in record between those two teams. That's Big East, Big 12 challenge. The Big 10 ACC challenge got underway last night. 3 wins for the ACC, 3 for the Big 10. Purdue will try to get a road win at Florida State. Do not think of this as your older brother's Florida State team. They are woeful this season. Purdue is a 15.5-point favorite. And I'm still seeing 4.5 for Indiana hosting North Carolina. That's tonight. 9:15 down at Assembly Hall.
Indiana by 12.
Yeah, I think Indiana will win comfortably.
Yeah, Indiana by 12.
This, to me, is the easiest of the 4 marquee non-conference games. Already won at Xavier, this one tonight. And then Arizona neutral floor in Kansas at Kansas coming up in mid-December.
College football playoff, Georgia, Michigan, TCU, USC, the top 4, no surprise there. What might be a surprise to some is that Ohio State is right there 5th. And lurking at 11-1 overall. Question now becomes, in the conference championship games, can a 13th game hurt you if you were to stub your toe? One might think for USC possible because that would be 2 losses, both of them coming to Utah. The Utes, by the way, are ranked 11th. The rest of the top 10, Alabama is 6th, Tennessee 7th. I was surprised Tennessee, by the way, is 7th. Penn State 8th, Clemson 9th, and Kansas State, who plays TCU, is 8th.
The youngest team of the World Cup is moving on to the knockout stage. That would be the United States men's national team. Christian Pulisic giving up his body for the goal yesterday. 1-0 victors over Iran, so they advance. They will take on the Netherlands on Saturday at 10 o'clock against a 16-team bracket now moving forward. Simply just one-and-done football the rest of the way. Here is what it sounded like yesterday on Pulisic finishing off a beautiful pass from Serginho Dest.
Robinson back for the captain, Tyler Adams. Austin McKay, Dest making a big run. It's meant for him. Dest is snuck in behind. Dest into the middle. Pulisic scores! Manu
pelvic contusion for Pulisic there for a while there. I was thinking more about the future of his...
Excuse me?
Trying to maybe create a child
what?
Or two.
You've been asleep all day.
I have not.
Mark Dighton. Like, at one point, I forgot you worked here. It's like when I thought maybe you were taking part of your 7 weeks vacation.
No, that'll be on Monday.
And then you come in with phallic sound effects.
That's a boing sound. There's nothing phallic about it.
Was that supposed to be the sound of the soccer ball?
Yeah, it was going off Death's head.
Okay.
Again, initially, I thought it was more...
Hubert?
In that region, but it sounded like a little bit more pelvic rib area for...
Pelvic is more like your side, isn't
like
it?
Kind of like hip-ish.
Yeah. Yeah, hip, area. Exactly. It's a bruise. Well,
it didn't look like he got hit in the hip by to me.
Well, I'm just
sounds like he's going to try to give it a go on Saturday. Again, the U.S. and the Netherlands. The United States goes through their three games here in the group stage without
allowing a goal, non-penalty. Now, can I just tell you this? I get very confused by this. The Netherlands is Holland. Is Holland just simply part of the Netherlands? Holland is like one island of the Netherlands. And then the Netherlands, I get confused because if you're from Holland, you're Dutch. But then I always think of Dutch as Denmark, but that's Danish, right?
Holland is a western coast of the Netherlands.
No, I think Holland is a very popular tourist Look spot here in Michigan.
That is correct. It is that as well,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I think my parents go there.
They have a lighthouse there. That
every other month.
Isn't everything supposed to be like, don't they have like wooden shoes and stuff in Holland?
Questions we probably Michigan, will not I mean? Throw at Tom Dienhart next. Purdue and Michigan in the Big Ten Championship this Saturday night at Lucas Oil Stadium. Let's chat a little Boiler football next.
It's the Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes and Sons Restoration. Make your game day experience the best it can be. Log on and get your tickets now. It's BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Need new tires? Skip the long appointments and bad coffee. With Go Mobile Tires Indy, order tires online and have them installed at your home or office. GoMobileIndy.com. We come to you.
A place for players to play and so much more. Pick up USA Fitness Noblesville, a better way to play. PickupUSAFitness.com.
Football season is underway, so now is the perfect time to download FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. Because right now, new customers get a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. Just sign up with promo code PLAY. FanDuel has all your favorite bets from the money line to point spreads to player props. So sign up today with promo code PLAY for your no-sweat first bet. Make every moment more this season with FanDuel, official sportsbook partner of the NFL.
21 plus in select states. First online real money wager only. Refund issued as non-withdrawable free bets that expires in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER or visit fanduel.com/RG in Colorado, Iowa, Michigan, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Illinois, and Virginia. 1-800-NEXT-STEP or text NEXT-STEP to 53342 in Arizona. 1-888-789-7777 or visit ccpg.org/chat in Connecticut. 1-800-9-WITH-IT in Indiana. 1-800-522-4700 or visit ksgamblinghelp.com in Kansas. 1-877-770-STOP Louisiana. 1-877-8-HOPE-NY or text HOPE-NY-467-369 in New York. Tennessee Red Line. 1-800-889-9789 in Tennessee. 1-800-522-4700 in Wyoming or visit 1-800-GAMBLER.net in West Virginia.
Get in zone. AutoZone.
Welcome to AutoZone. What are you working on today? Starting trouble. No one likes that. We'll get you set up for some stronger starts. You might just need a fresh charge, and we'll take care of that free of charge. But if it is time for a new battery, we've got replacement batteries that'll fit your needs, starting at just $79.99. You can learn more about our battery selection at AutoZone.com. That's what makes us America's number one battery destination.
Get in zone, AutoZone.
Claim based on data from the NPD Group 2021.
Lions, Tigers, and tailgates. Oh my. The college football season is always a great time of year. Besides the jerseys, the face paint, and the foam fingers, there's the food. And nothing gets you more fired up for game day than Eckridge smoked sausage. They're naturally hardwood smoked and have the perfect blend of spices. From buffalo sausage dip to sausage chili mac and cheese, Eckridge smoked sausage is a quick way to bring flavor to all your tailgate meals. Visit Eckridge.com for easy, one-of-a-kind sausage recipes. Eckridge, you do you.
Introducing Spectrum One. Get Spectrum Internet with speeds of 300 megabits per second. Advanced Wi-Fi with best-in-class security and privacy. Spectrum Mobile with unlimited talk, text, and data, plus nationwide 5G. Get it all with Spectrum One. Spectrum Internet, advanced Wi-Fi, and one line of Spectrum Mobile unlimited for only $49.99 a month. Visit Spectrum.com or a Spectrum store today. Valid for qualified residential customers only. Service not available in all areas. Restrictions apply.
Christmas cheer is in short supply for our neighbors who are hungry, homeless, hurting,
Today you can give them meals, shelter, and care with a gift to Wheeler Mission. You'll also provide addiction recovery, life skills, job training, and other vital care that transforms lives. Your gift is needed right now as hundreds of hurting people are turning to Wheeler Mission for help every day. Share Christmas cheer. Donate now at WheelerMission.org. That's WheelerMission.org.
He'll be better for it next time. Us as players, it moves slower. It feels different to us when we're out on the field. We feel like we got it. We can run three plays in 10 seconds.
If you're talking about it,
people upstairs, they're moving at a different pace.
We're talking about it.
And everybody's like, chaotic. So this is the first opportunity that he had to do something like this. Do I think it'll happen again in the future? No.
Your home for Indy sports, 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan. You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
You know, here's the way I look at it for Purdue, okay? Purdue playing Michigan in the Big Ten title game. And what we know is this, Kevin. What we know is that Purdue became the national darling a few years ago in the Rondell Moore game when they blew out Ohio State and, as a result of that, spared all of us across the country watching all of those Ohio State people and that one Buckeye fella that paints his face from being in the playoffs and all that stuff, right?
Yeah, the Tyler Trent game, right?
Correct, yes. So, I would like to see Purdue win the Big Ten championship. But if they do not and they fall short against Michigan, I'm just simply chalking that up as Purdue once again doing their part to spare us the plague of Ohio State again being in the college football playoff. Because if Purdue were to beat Michigan, although it seems ridiculous that Ohio State would replace the team that beat them by three touchdowns at Ohio State.
There's no way Ohio State would replace Michigan.
You don't think so?
No way. Michigan just beat them last week by three scores.
I know, but
place.
You've got, I mean, if Michigan loses to an unranked Purdue, you don't think that falters them three spots?
No, not when you have the head-to-head so recent.
Okay, well, I hope you're right.
At Ohio State as well.
I hope you're right.
Let's chat more about Saturday night inside of Lucas Oil Stadium. It's going to be an awesome atmosphere. Really looking forward to it. Purdue and Michigan. Tom Dienhart, who covers the Boilers for On3.com, is with us right now. Tom, I guess let's start with Aidan O'Connell and everything he's been through this past week. Just kind of the latest update on him. I assume the expectation is he will try and give it a go again Saturday.
Yeah, you want to ask him that on Monday.
Okay. Is that peanuts?
Now, you know, here's the thing. Purdue is known, of course, of being the school that landed the first man on the moon, right? The second one from Purdue is actually on the phone with us right now, right?
Is that Neil? Is that Mr. Armstrong right
well,
there?
Well, Mr. Armstrong's no longer with us, but but that sounds like a connection from where he's been, for sure.
Yeah, a hair muffled there. We'll try and get Tom Dienhart.
A hair muffled, he said.
Could you make out what he was saying there?
Yeah. He was saying, Linus, we're ready for recess. That's what he was saying.
16 and...
Did he land? Has the Apollo landed?
He's here.
Tom, do we got you?
I am here. Sorry about that. Don't know what was up.
Boy, that sounds pristine. Thank you for that. Was asking about Aidan O'Connell, Tom, and just maybe when you first got wind of what he was going through off the field and the latest update on him, just kind of practice-wise, heading into Saturday night.
I first heard something during that IU game, during the process of that IU game, and then obviously people saw Aidan on the sideline, unconsolable, and then Jeff Blom was asked in the postgame about it. He got very emotional about it, didn't provide any details. And then, of course, Aidan sends out the social media message on Sunday sort of explaining what's going on. And, yeah, you can only imagine how he's able to battle through and play in that old Oakham Bucket game. And, you know, talking to Jeff Brom Monday and then Brian Brom yesterday, you know, Aidan is still not on campus, understandably. Still back home taking care of family matters. Not sure when he's going to return, but – you know, Jeff Blom thinks he's going to be ready to go, and he will play on Saturday. So, yeah, just an incredible storyline that's, you know, really overarching this big moment for the Purdue football program.
Tom, with that, it has been a circuitous journey for Purdue to get to this point into the Big Ten championship game. Obviously, the Big Ten West was very topsy-turvy. There are two ways to look at it. One would be that for Purdue, it's house money. Nobody expects them to beat Michigan. What the heck? Let's go for it. Let's have fun with it. You do have the Aidan O'Connell story maybe that bonds the team together and rallies around their leader in that regard. But the other way to look at it is that Purdue hears so much about this disparity west to east and Michigan being the team that's just going to waltz its way into the playoff that Purdue just folds up tent, psychologically speaking. Have you gotten any sense in seeing the program or the players themselves, like what kind of pep is in their step or which way they're rolling here?
Well, I think just the guys we talked to last night after practice, Payne Durham especially, they realize their role here. They know they're the underdog, and I think they already are embracing that. 16.5-point underdogs the last time I checked. So, yeah, and you talked about house money. And that's a great way to put it. At this point, it's all gravy for Purdue, right? All the pressure is on Michigan. They're the playoff team. They're the defending Big Ten champ, and they're supposed to roll over Purdue. So, again, it's nice to play in that underdog role. And, again, I think Purdue has embraced that. It's a role they've excelled at, guys. And you probably saw the stat right on Jeff Brohm. He's 3-0 at Purdue against top three-ranked teams. So these moments haven't been too big for him. When that spotlight's glaring really brightly.
Again, Tom Dienhart with us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline on 3.com, covers the Boilers. If you look at Michigan last year, they beat Ohio State in the Big House. They come to Indianapolis, and they did not overlook Iowa whatsoever in clinching their playoff berth. Purdue and Michigan have not seen each other really at all over the past decade. I think it's only one time. Just overall thoughts on this matchup specifically of what you've seen from Michigan. They look tremendous on Saturday, but, they've struggled with Maryland at home for a while. I think Illinois hung in there. I mean, hell, I think Indiana might have had a lead at halftime or hanging in there for a half in Bloomington. Just kind of strengths and weaknesses for Purdue versus Michigan.
Yeah, Rutgers was leading at halftime out in Piscataway earlier this year as well, so they're very good, very physical, kind of like a Bo Schembechler 1985 Michigan team. They want to run the ball, and they've had the big-time running backs in Donovan Edwards and Blake Corm, obviously, but Blake Corm's probably not going to play. And the quarterback, J.J. McCarthy, right, he's the guy that I think Ohio State last week dared to throw the ball, and he did just that and showed he could hit some big plays down the field. And defensively, right, front to back, it's excellent. Brian Brohm said last night, going to be the best defense they see all year, so there's just really not many weaknesses on either side of the ball. I think if you're pretty offensive, you got to try to keep it away from Michigan, right? Devin Mockaby kind of gives you a ground game, and he can maybe extend possessions for you, and that would open up obviously the pass game for O'Connell and company. And defensively, I guess you hope Michigan maybe commits 3 or 4 turnovers. Because I think the only way Purdue wins this thing is if they score, again, like an unconventional touchdown on defense or special teams. So it could happen. We see crazy things happen all the time, but it's going to take almost a perfect meeting of the football gods for Purdue probably to pull this one off.
Any guess or idea on the ticket split inside of Lucas Oil Saturday night? Again, Michigan there last year. You would think Michigan fans are probably looking to save a little bit for the playoff. Any idea of what it could look like in there?
Yeah, most pundits think, guys, if Michigan even, should they get upset, they're still going to go to the playoff. They still want to win the ball game, but there's always that's got to be in the back of everybody's mind. And you're right, if you're a Michigan fan, maybe you save your money for that playoff game. I'm not sure about the split. I know I asked somebody at Purdue yesterday how many tickets the athletic department got. I was told 10,000. And I know the student tickets sold out very quickly among the kids here in West Lafayette. So, maybe it's close to being a 50-50 crowd. You think with the excitement for Purdue fans only 60 miles away that they can maybe have even an edge from a fan standpoint come kickoff at 8 p.m. down there in Lucas Oil.
Tom Dienhart is our guest, by the way, talking Purdue football here, who takes on Michigan in the Big Ten title game. You can read Tom's work at On3, that's the number 3, on3.com. Tom, Jeff Brohm has been very offensive at times, particularly kind of in his rise towards when he came to Purdue. offensively, he can be aggressive in the fact of not afraid to kind of pull rabbits out of the hat or just do different looks, different things. Seemingly for Purdue, you know, as you talked about with that Michigan defense, that maybe Purdue's going to have to get a little bit creative here. Are we going to see Purdue just say, hey, here's who we are and here's what we do and try to stop it? Or are they going to try to do some of that house money, let's just come up with wild wrinkles type scenarios?
I think he's going to have some type of a wrinkle. He typically does, right? And why not let it all hang out? I mean, like we spoke about moments ago, they've got nothing to lose, right? This is house money. This is gravy. And go down blazing, right? And we've all seen Jeff Rom over 6 years be pretty innovative from an offensive standpoint. And I got to think he'll have one or two things that Michigan hasn't seen that he hopes maybe gives him some type of an edge. Maybe it lets him get a key first down at a certain juncture of the game or at the goal line, and it creates a situation where they can get 6 points instead of a field goal. So, yeah, I do think we are going to see something. Now, that's his strength, right? He's. I think most Saturdays, guys, in most of these games in 6 years, I think when he looks across the field, I think he has a little bit of an edge schematically. Not always the best players, but I think schematically he has an edge. And it's going to be tough to do that against Harbaugh, but I think Jeff Rom will come up with a wrinkle or two to try to give Purdue an edge, especially, like I said, at a critical juncture in the ballgame.
I was going to say, I feel like the bag of tricks for Jeff Brohm always seems to have something in there in these sorts of matchups. Again, Tom Dienhart is with us, covers Purdue football for On3.com. This is a very dumb question, Tom. If Purdue wins, they go to the Rose Bowl, right?
That's what I'm told. I've checked with Jerry Palm on that. And I know the Rose Bowl, some story came out about the Rose Bowl changing its criteria, but as far as I still know, from what I'm told, especially by Jerry, of course, Jerry is the CBS Sports Bowl expert. He's also a bracketologist. You guys have probably talked to him, I'm sure. And Big Ten champ, it's not going to playoff. He's supposed to go to the Rose Bowl.
And then if they were to lose, what do you see as bowl options for Purdue?
Now, Jerry told me when I talked to him a couple of days ago, he thinks – and most likely they're going to go to Florida. He didn't see them not going to a bowl in Florida. So that means going to Orlando, the Citrus Bowl, or going to the bowl in Tampa, the ReliaQuest Bowl, which used to be the Outback Bowl. Yes. Right now, Jerry and others have Purdue playing in Orlando against LSU. The big key for Purdue, the big key for Purdue is going to be getting Penn State into a New Year's Six Bowl. And most people think Penn State is going to get to the Cotton Bowl. And that's going to happen because LSU got beat by A&M last week. I don't want to get too deep in the weeds here. But, again, it's setting up right now for Purdue to land in Florida, most likely the Citrus Bowl, should they lose this ball game on Saturday night. So, heck, the Boilers have not played a bowl game in the Sunshine State since 2006. And they played in Orlando back then. So, again, I'm sure the Boilermaker fans would love to go take their pale bodies to Florida in early January, watch some football, catch some rays, right?
Do they still have the Pull-On Weed Eater Independence Bowl?
Oh, man, no. And I have a moment of silence every New Year's Day for that, for the
because Tom, the only thing better than going to Shreveport, Louisiana, is telling people you're in the Pull-On Weed Eater Independence Bowl, right?
Now we got the Cheez-It Bowl, which isn't quite as good. But
hey, Clemson won the Cheez-It Bowl last year. I got a box of Cheez-Its from it.
See, that's nice. And then we got the Duke Mayo Bowl where you get mayo.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they got the mayo splash, yep.
There's an outside shop where you could go to that bowl. Can you imagine Jeff Brohm getting mayo?
Oh, yeah. I love that.
I don't want to be that guy.
I mean, Purdue fans taking their family down to Florida to take on LSU.
I think mayo probably goes pretty well with a lot of like Wisconsin should go to the Mayo Bowl. That fits right with their fan base, doesn't it?
They can dip their cheese curds in mayo, right?
That's exactly right.
Tom, enjoy Saturday night. I think it's going to be an awesome, awesome atmosphere down here in Indianapolis. Purdue fans with ups and downs of this season. Going to be a great atmosphere in there. And house money, as Jake has said, that's an accurate way to put it with Purdue and Michigan this Saturday night. Going to be a fun game to cover inside of Lucas Oil. Tom, thanks for the time this morning.
Hey, thank you very much for having me, guys. Take care.
That's Tom Dienhart right there. On the Payless Liquors.
I don't even have house money, right? I've got like apartment money.
How about that? Purdue-LSU, that would be an interesting bowl matchup. Purdue-Auburn did not go very well a few years ago in the bowl game.
That was 56-0 after the first, right?
I thought after the opening kickoff, it was 56-0.
It's pretty bad.
Our old boss, Jeff Smoley, going to join us next, Jake.
His alma mater's waiting up for a bowl here, right?
I wonder if he's nervous about Friday night at all after those college football rankings, although watching his team against my Irish on Saturday, he should not be nervous with Caleb Williams under center. We'll talk about a new book and maybe a little holiday present for those out there coming up next here. Jeff Smolian joins us next.
107.5 The Fan is your one-stop shop for the Indianapolis sports fan. Colts, Pacers, IU, Purdue, and insights from Kevin Bowen, Dan Dockett, Jake Query. Your home for indie sports. 107.5thefan.com.
You know, we're talking about great things in Indianapolis right now. Nothing short of amazing with QC Kinetics. If you've got any joint pain, they deserve a call from you. Again, we're talking about no drugs, no surgery, no downtime. QC Kinetics help you out with pain in your knees, hips, back, shoulder. They are the nation's leader in regenerative medicine, and they've got clinics over in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. Sounds like more are on the way. Modern advances in regenerative medicine that allow the medical professionals to take the remarkable healing properties from your own body, concentrate them for maximum power, and put them directly into your aching joints so your damaged tissue can be repaired and restored naturally. So many people are living their best life again, pain-free, thanks to QC Kinetics. So give them a call, 463-235-7160. We'll give you a free consultation. Again, locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. QC Kinetics, 463-235-7160.
On Wednesday, November 30th,
the hottest ticket in town,
AEW makes the return to the Indiana Farmers Coliseum at the Indiana State Fairgrounds for its only live show of the year. AEW Dynamite and AEW Rampage promise to be one of the biggest events of the year. Don't miss Kenny Omega, The Young Bucks,
oh, wow.
MJF.
I'm a generational talent.
Saraya.
I am. The Revolution.
John Moxley.
Get in the ring with me. It's dangerous as all hell.
Ryan Danielson. Claudio Castagnoli. Dr. Britt Baker, DMD. Jamie Hayter. Eddie Kingston. Orange Cassidy. The Acclaimed.
Everyone love The Acclaimed.
Swerve in Our Glory. Jade, FTR.
Tough guys.
Tony Storm. Wardlow. Chris Jericho. And the Jericho Appreciation Society.
And that's entertainment.
Darby Allin. Sting. And many more will be there live.
Oh!
Don't miss AEW Live at the Indiana Farmers Coliseum. Tickets make a great holiday gift and are on sale right now. Go to AEWTIX.com now. Card subject to change.
Hey there, it's Jake Query for the Good Feet Store of Indiana. You know, I love the arch support specialists of the Good Feet Store. Two locations, Greenwood, and then, of course, at 82nd and Dean in the Clearwater area. Jake, that's great. What exactly is the Good Feet Store? Well, I'll tell you. Good Feet Store, again, arch support specialist that'll help you become pain-free. Think about what area of your body makes contact with something every single day. It's your feet. And I've had plantar fasciitis. I've had all kinds of issues with my ankles. And then I found out about the Good Feet Store, went in. Chris did a very simple, no obligation, by the way, no hassle, and no appointment necessary to do a scan of my foot, just basically an imprint, that allowed them to see where the pressure points were, and then I got the three-step, and by that I mean for three different kinds of shoes that you might wear throughout the course of the day, three-step system of arch supports that are designed to the contour of my foot. And now all of a sudden, pain-free. That's what I love about the Good Feet Store. I'm confident in the product. It's American-made. It has a lifetime warranty, and I'm confident that you will love it as well. I'd love for you to give them a look. GoodFeetIndy.com is the website. Again, Greenwood and in Clearwater at 82nd and Dean.
The Venter X card from Capital One gives you more of what you love, like premium travel benefits and access to Taylor Swift tickets. Ooh, I do love her. Earn 5x miles on flights and 10x miles on hotels through Capital One Travel.
Enjoy your stay in Suite 13.
Whoa, 13? That's Taylor's lucky number. Plus, get access to Taylor Swift The Eras Tour, presented by Capital One. Maybe I'll see you there. The Venter X card from Capital One. What's in your wallet?
Terms apply. See CapitalOne.com for details.
Get in zone, AutoZone.
Welcome to AutoZone. What are you working on today? Ah, thinking about gas mileage. You know, changing your oil with a full synthetic oil like Pennzoil Platinum can help your engine get more miles. Right now, you can get 5 quarts with an STP Extended Life Oil Filter for only $38.99. Get everything you need for better fuel efficiency at any of our 6,200 stores or on AutoZone.com.
Get in zone, AutoZone.
Restrictions apply.
In the construction business and tired of dealing with the indifference of big corporate suppliers, Quality Supply and Tool on South Harding Street understands. For over 25 years, owner Kevin Ane has had a different approach.
We at Quality Supply and Tool take pride in being a locally owned family business committed to service. And every customer's needs are different, and we truly believe in shaping our business to our customers' needs. That's what separates us from the competition.
That's Quality Supply and Tool, with additional locations in Bloomington and Jeffersonville to serve Hoosiers better. Partner with Quality Supply and Tool and think outside the box.
The Pacers head to Sacramento for a game with the Kings tonight at 9:30 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Now, Mark, did you notice that this morning I showered?
I did.
I know you weren't
Kevin
there
did too,
for
I
it.
Think, but... Which is a nice change of pace for both of you.
Well, we knew that we had to look professional, right?
Why always. Start now?
What's... Always.
I mean, I don't perceive myself as a professional broadcaster, but Kevin, as you know, that when there are people that I consider to be professional, I figure that we need to look at least upkept.
Right? I couldn't agree more. Jeff Smullyan is with us in studio. Jeff, of course, what he... as done and did with MS Communications speaks for itself, and an unbelievable history in sports radio, the godfather of it, and has got a new book, Never Ride a Roller Coaster Upside Down, and want to chat about that and a whole lot with you here because you are on the Board of Trustees at USC right now, and
yes.
I'm sitting there watching that game on Saturday night thinking, I think Colts fans might cut off a pinky for a Lincoln Riley-Caleb Williams combo, but you probably wouldn't like that, right?
Well, no. What I would say is I wanted the NFL to do what the NBA used to do, draft futures, and the Colts draft Caleb Williams a year in advance like the Celtics did with Larry Bird. Because I think he's the best quarterback I've ever seen at SC. Friends have seen him play UCLA and Notre Dame the last couple weeks, said, my gosh, he's really good. I said, he does this every single week. Every week he does something, you sit there and go, wow, I can't believe that play.
Escapability. It's like he is always a step ahead. Nothing rattles him around him. The pressure comes, and he just kind of pushes people off him.
And he could be on a full run and throw the ball 40 yards down the field and hit somebody in stride. And you just sit there and go, how did he do that? And he does it every week.
Well, you know, obviously, Jeff Smullyan, you're involved, very involved, for those that don't know, in USC athletics.
Yeah.
And so, you know, University of Southern California, I think now it's well publicized, gave Lincoln Riley all of Orange County and half of San Diego to come out there, and it's paid off.
But not a Bakersfield. No Bakersfield.
But did you anticipate this kind of a return on investment this early in the tenure?
No, I got involved with the athletic department because of the economics of the Pac-12, so I spent a lot of time and got to know Mike Bone very well. When Mike Bone first said he thought he had a shot at Lincoln Riley, I went, oh my gosh, I can't believe you can. Everybody knew that we needed to change the culture dramatically, and certainly I didn't think that you would be, you know, 11-1 the first year and should have beaten Utah.
You know, a lot of people, Jeff, would critique, and I probably have been in this school of thought, the debate just, you know, in terms of the money that goes into athletics and paying a coach a lot of money and everything else. And then I look at it and I say, but there probably is an ROI with that because of not only the marketability of the program, but I would assume the revenue that comes in terms of alumni pride off of a dominant program like that in terms of donations that it pays for itself. Now, is that fair?
Yeah, yes and no. And I spent almost 4 years working on the economics of the Pac-12 for USC. And as you know, the end result was we ended up going to the Big Ten.
Right.
And people say, how could you do that? And it's simple. $50 to $70 million a year more for the university. But it is pride. I had a former president said, you know, it's not the donations. Somebody doesn't give you $200 million to name the School of Liberal Arts because they like your running backs. Those donations come because of the desire for academic excellence. But it does build a sense of pride. My friend who was president of the university said, you'd be amazed how many Nobel laureates want to come out here to teach because they like football too. So there are byproducts.
72 and sunny helps too, Kevin.
Right. Yeah, exactly. We've got a ton to get to with you. Again, Never Ride a Roller Coaster Upside Down. I think some Ken Griffey Jr., some David Letterman, some Andrew Luck type stories. Like you said, the USC move to the Big Ten, something to hit on as well. And then just the godfather of sports radio. Without Jeff, certainly we are not here today. So we'll chat about that coming up in the 9 o'clock hour. Kevin and Query right here on 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Dan Dockage lays some knowledge.
Phil Cowher was right. He was right because you got a guy in there that did not know what he was doing and had no idea what he was seeing. Jeff Saturday yells about pancakes and, oh, blah, blah, blah. Okay, great. Every single game is organic. I'm watching the Colts try to get lined up, and I'm screaming call a timeout. It had nothing to do with the time. They had plenty of time. It was because he didn't have a feel for the game.
Dan Dockage, weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Prepare for snow at the mower shop in Fishers with a new gas or electric Toro snowblower. Get ready for mower season next year with discounts on select Spartan mowers. 849-9500 or mowershop.com.
Enjoy all your favorite sports like never before at BetMGM. Sign up using the code THEFAN, capital T, capital F, all one word, and your first wager is risk-free up to $1,000. When you register with BetMGM, you'll get instant access to a variety of parlay selection features, live betting options, player props, and daily boosted odds specials. With BetMGM at your fingertips, every game and every play matter more than ever. Sign up today and find out why nothing beats a win at the King of Sportsbooks. Download the BetMGM app today or go to BetMGM.com and again, enter that code THEFAN, all one word, and place your first wager risk-free. Visit BetMGM.com for terms and conditions. 21 years of age or older to wager. Indiana only. New customer offer. All promotions are subject to qualification and eligibility requirements. Rewards issued as non-withdrawable free bets or site credit. Free bets expire 7 days from issuance. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem and wants help, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Hey, JMV here for the absolute best in realty. Mark Deedle, 317-755-4232. That's Mark Deedle Realty, 317-755-4232, markdeedle.com, Mark D-I-E-T-E-L.com today. Let's talk about Richard in Maryland and Indy. It was time to downsize. Going to move into a place with a little bit of help. Now, the best price was the focus to pay for the higher cost of the assisted living. Who do they call upon? Of course, the absolute best in the business. That's Mark Deedle. Mark Deedle got the job done right. I'm telling you, no matter what your situation, downsizing or upgrading, you always go with the best, and that's Mark Deedle. He's going to guarantee an offer in 3 days for full market value, or he will list it for free. Call Mark Deedle today, 317-755-4232, 317-755-4232, markdeedle.com. That's Mark D-I-E-T-E-L.com today.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W29ABB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
Hey, join me today. We're going to preview Indiana, North Carolina. What a freaking game in Assembly Hall tonight. I have a surprise guest as well. Join me today, noon to 3.
You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
That music that you hear right there is quite possibly what would be playing on this radio station if it not were not for our next guest, who was kind of the original brains and vision behind Sports Talk Radio. That's just one of the things that can be read about in his new book, Never Ride a Roller Coaster Upside Down. We're talking about Jeff Smullyan of Emmis, who joins us here in the studio on Kevin and Query on a good-looking, by the way, Wednesday morning to you. Good morning to you, Jake Query, along with Kevin Bowen. And first off, Jeff, before we get to talking about, because there are a billion things we could talk about with you, I don't know that people understand or were aware of your involvement in this facilitation of USC and UCLA joining into the Big Ten and then the dominoes that could fall with that. But before we get to that, let me just simply ask, the book itself, what was the original brainstorm of, you know what, I should write a book, and take me through the process of being able to do that?
Well, I have an 18-year-old daughter who, by the way, is not at USC. She's a freshman at Georgetown and loves it there. I would take her to school every day. So from kindergarten until she fired me when she got her driver's license.
So that's what I have to look forward to?
Oh, yeah.
You're saying with my daughter?
Yeah, the pink slip will come in. But we just talk about life every day. We always had a 30-minute drive, and we talk about, I'm sort of a lesson guy. Here's what I learned here. Here's what I learned there. Here's the story about that. And one day she said, Dad, nobody would ever believe these stories. You got to write it down. And when COVID came, things were slow. And I'm one of those people who stayed at home for about 4 days. And then the dogs and the wife and the daughter, I sort of said, you know, I could be quieter in my office here upstairs. So I came in and just started writing. And the next thing I knew, I had about 300 pages, sent it off to a couple friends who both said, you know, you got a book here. And then the next thing I knew, I got an editor who was fabulous, who helped me. She'd say, this is extraneous. This doesn't move the story along. Amplify this. And then we got an agent and a publisher, and here we are.
One of the anecdotes in there comes courtesy of David Letterman, and he had a quote saying that you gave him the confidence to leave Indianapolis.
Yeah, that would be a fictitious quote. David, I think what he meant was your management was so bad, I needed to leave Indiana. I think that's what David meant.
No, I don't think he meant that. Your relationship with David and how all of that unfolded.
Yeah, David was really nice enough to do a quote for the book, as was Andrew, who is my next door neighbor.
Andrew Luck, for those
Andrew
who don't
Luck, know. And Jerry Reinsdorf, who's been like a big brother to me, and Evan By and Ken Griffey Jr. and Sr., all the people that I worked with. And but David really was just absolutely brilliant. When he took the job with us at the first radio station ever ran, he said, I'm gonna do this for a year, I'm gonna go to Hollywood and see if I can become a writer. It worked out pretty well.
Yeah, I would say.
Jeff, what's interesting to me is that as you're writing that book, you probably are realizing different people that you have rubbed elbows with, worked with, mentored, whatever it may be.
Yeah.
And I would imagine that that creates in you a feeling of like, wow, like I've met some really interesting, really fascinating people. But is it surreal for you to realize and recognize that there are other people that someday in their book will have the same pride of the fact that they met Jeff Smullyan?
Well, you know, you always hope so. I think the thing I'm proudest of is sort of the things that we did and stood for. The point of the book is, is you do fail as much as you succeed. Understand the failures and laugh about them. When you talked about sports radio, that was a project I always wanted to do. And when I presented it to our managers, they pretty much laughed.
And that would have been what year?
1986, when we talked about it. We launched it in 87. I have two chapters in the book. One is one of my favorite sayings is a line between being a genius and an idiot is very fine. And I've been on both sides many times. So the chapter about Fan is idiot to genius because nobody wanted to do it. Rick Cummings to this day laughs about it. We had a manager's vote and it failed. So we weren't going to do it. And Rick Cummings, who's been with me since the beginning, came in the next day with Doyle Rose and said, you know what? We owe you one. We're going to do this idea of all sports radio, but we want to let you know it's stupid. And it was,
and this was in New York, right?
This is in New York City, WFAN. And then it was a bomb for about a year. And then we bought the NBC stations and merged it and put Imus on and Mike and the Mad Dog. And then it became the hottest radio station in America. So I went from idiot to genius on the same project. And then following up on that, then we dealt with the New York Mets. We knew baseball. I always loved baseball. People said, you guys are marketing wizards. We need marketing wizards in Seattle. So I went to Seattle as the boy wonder. And I was a hero. And then 3 years later, I was probably the biggest pariah in the entire state of Washington, which is tough. But I went from genius to idiot. So it happens. And I think the fun thing about the book is just telling the stories and reliving them. And hopefully people will find it funny. Hopefully people will learn from the lessons, good and bad. And maybe learn some things about the economics of all these businesses.
Why were you so bullish on sports talk radio having staying power, particularly in local markets?
I thought that the future of especially in those days, AM radio, was not going to be music. We were sort of pioneers in building FM music stations. And when we got to New York, it was a simple math question. I said, look, if the future of AM is music, FM is music and AM is talk. There's two all news stations, WINS and WCBS. There's two talk stations, WOR and WABC. So if we're going to ever do sports talk, and I'm also sort of the believer that radio is like an anchor tenant, like a shopping center. We had the Mets, so that was your big tenant. And then so we had the Mets and we built it around it. And It worked.
But if you would have seen in the vision and in the future that eventually it would lead to the pairing of this radio program, you would have stopped the roller coaster, right?
That would have been, I would have voted against it that day in New York in 1980. If I had said, I got to deal with Jake and Kevin, I would have said, no, I'm not doing that.
That's right.
How did it come to be the ownership of the Mariners and just maybe some stuff behind the scenes that the common fan wouldn't know about what it means to own a professional sports franchise?
Well, and everybody said it's an ego thing, and we've always said, look, we always looked at the economics of any business. We like the business. Buying a baseball team was really a recognition of the future of television and cable TV. We saw it coming, as I always said, we saw it, but we were too early. The market was not the right market. But I loved it. I thought I always say you do your best management in the toughest situations. We did some things there for the game day experience and the average fan that had never been done before. All sorts of in-stadium stuff, fireworks, crazy video clips, which you see now everywhere. One of my favorite projects was doing situational music to things, which was a lot of fun. I can still remember the one that we thought we were going to get kicked out of baseball for. The Yankees had Louis Polonia, and Louis Polonia had an underage incident in Milwaukee. And when he came up to bat, we played, she was just 17, you know what I mean? And we thought that was going to be problematic, but
probably wouldn't fly today.
Yeah. But at any rate, we had all sorts of fun and did great things, but the market was tough. The community had never embraced the team. And I've said, we weren't rich enough. You had to be, I joked it once, to own the Mariners or the Milwaukee Brewers or the Kansas City Royals, you had to be a billionaire in those days. If you owned the Yankees or the Dodgers, if you had a paper route that was moderately successful, it was okay. But the math was bad. We just couldn't afford it.
Could you see Indy ever having an MLB team?
I got into it wanting to put a team in Indianapolis.
Were you part of the Arrows group with Art and Gotti?
Yeah, peripherally, yeah. They were friends. Art and Gotti was a friend, and I worked with them a little bit. And the math just never worked. As it became a game of region, number one, it became a game of disposable income, suites and ticket sales and signage, and it also became a game of cable TV. And if you look at Indianapolis's cable market, you get 60 miles to the south and you're in Reds territory. Correct. And you get to Lafayette and you're in Cubs and White Sox territory. Terre Haute's always been Cardinals territory. So the math didn't work. We actually had a chance to move a team here after I was out of baseball. And I thought,
which
about
team would it have been?
Well, it was when the Expos were
okay,
and they didn't know what to do with the Expos. We talked, and I talked to some friends in baseball, and one dear friend said, look, you've had bad economics before. Do you really want to have worse economics in your own town?
Do you believe that, there is some uncertainty is maybe the wrong word.
Yeah.
Jeff Smolian is our guest, by the way, and the book is Never Ride a Roller Coaster Upside Down, The Ups, Downs, and Reinvention of an Entrepreneur. The Pacers are in, here you have in the NBA, your old market of Seattle.
Yeah.
It seems inevitable they're going to end up with the team. Las Vegas, one would think, is going to end up with the team. And just based on market size, I do worry. I don't have anything to base it on, but I worry about, after Herb Simon, the long-term viability in Indianapolis for the Pacers. Is that a valid concern?
Yeah, it is. We are too small to have two pro sports teams. We're very fortunate. We always talk about ourselves as the 20th market or the 15th market. We're about the 40th metropolitan area in population. It is a tribute to the Simon family and to the Irsays that they have stayed here. And of course, the NFL doesn't matter much. You give me an NFL team in Tipton and I'll be happy.
Right, right.
But I think Simon is as committed as Herb. And I think that's why they're doing this whole renovation. And I do believe the NBA will expand into Phoenix. And there's a long reason why they didn't stay in Seattle, and a lot of the same things we had. Seattle is a wonderful place, very tough for support like this. I got in trouble once and said, if I had these problems in Indianapolis, I could meet with the corporate community and the government and solve them in 3 days. And that was true with the Sonics. It was true with us. Just the way it was.
So you do believe, though, that the Pacers will long-term stay in Indy?
I think so. I really do. Yeah.
What's Andrew Luck like as a neighbor?
Andrew's the nicest guy in the world. Just could not be a nicer person. Andrew's getting his master's at Stanford this year.
Yeah, education, right?
Yep. And it could not be a nicer person.
You know, if he moves, he won't tell you ahead of time, right? We know that
I love Andrew. I have people always say, well, what's your next door neighbor doing? And I go, yeah, I don't know.
Traveling the world, right?
Yeah.
They just welcome their second kid in.
Yeah. They have Penelope, and she was born this summer right before they went to Palo Alto. But wonderful person. When I did this book, we were talking one day. He said, let me read it. And so he read like the first draft of it and could not have been nicer.
What do you think he ends up doing?
I think he'll coach. My guess is he'll coach. I think he'll coach high school athletics. Andrew is a brilliant guy who can do just about anything.
Jeff, I've always applauded Andrew Luck in the fact that I've never bought into, you know, the people that say, well, he quit on his franchise and he set them back. Listen, I mean, he's a guy that I think looked into the crystal ball, right, and said, you know what, I want to be able to pick up my daughter and walk through the yard with her. But if he is in graduate school at Stanford right now, the question for you would be, does that mean that he is going to be attending graduate school at a future Big Ten institution?
If I had to bet, I would bet that the next wave, and it won't be for a while, is that the Big Ten and the SEC will end up with 20 schools. And if I had to bet, I would say it would be the pairing would, interestingly enough, Notre Dame and Stanford. There's a wonderful academic parallel there. And probably Washington and Oregon.
So you're saying 20 schools each or a merger? Because
no,
the Big 20,
20 schools each.
Right,
Big
right.
10 of 20 and
so
the Pac.
I'm thinking the Big 10 right now is at what number are they at
16.
Right now?
16. SC and UCLA will be 15 and 16.
Okay, so then four that would have to be added.
Yeah.
And you think that's Stanford? Stanford would seemingly pair well with Notre Dame, right?
Right.
That leaves two then.
Right.
Oregon, Washington?
I would, if I had to bet. And again, total, I have no knowledge. If I had to bet, the SEC will add four and the Big Ten will add four more.
Is Notre Dame the white whale in all of this? Like,
yeah, they are. Jack, and you know, Jack used to work with us and I love him dearly.
Jack Swarbrick, the AD right, there.
Yeah. And, you know, Jack has always been able to be independent and can. They've had this deal where they have their own deal with NBC and then they get some ACC revenues. But I think at the end of the day, if there's two super conferences, Notre Dame will be one of the two. And it certainly would be the Big Ten because of academics.
You obviously have seen a ton of events come across the city of Indianapolis in your time. Do you think in the next, I don't know, 15, 20 years, Indy gets another Super Bowl?
I think so. I think we, you know, we dazzled people with the one we had. And I knew some NFL people, and I joked and said, if a drop of snow falls anywhere between here and Peoria, it will be picked up before it hits the ground. They were dazzled. I think we got it because there's sort of an unwritten rule. You build a new stadium and Northern City gets one. But I think, you know, we clearly are the best in the world in doing things like this. Only Indianapolis could play all 63 NCAA basketball games. So, yeah, I do.
What is the failure, Jeff Smullyan, that most kept you at times from feeling 100% confident, and what is the failure that most motivated you?
Well, I think the failure was, you know, I mean, listen, the first station I ever ran, the one with Letterman didn't work. The Mariners was, I always say, it's one thing to fail, it's another thing to fail in front of 30,000 people every night. But I think they always motivated me. I think the biggest failure was seeing the company collapse in 2009 when everybody said, you're going to go bankrupt. And me and a number of wonderful people who were still upstairs basically said, we're not going to let that happen. We're going to save this darn thing. And we did. We at one point, Amos had over $1.6 billion of debt. We paid it all off. Today we have money in the bank. I think that was a failure that I think I was very proud of the people around me who just said, we're not going to quit and we're going to save this thing.
What led to you wanting to create Emmis and then put it right here on the Circle?
Well, I always wanted to do this. I was a kid who grew up listening to baseball games and rock and roll music. And I've told my daughter, who's now a freshman in college, she's, gee, I don't know what I'll do yet. I said, look, I was an anomaly. I knew I wanted to do radio when I was probably 15 years old, maybe earlier. And I went to school, studied broadcasting, got a law degree. In those days, nobody said get an MBA. They said go get a law degree. I studied broadcast law. And I always knew I wanted to start my own company. And my dad, I was going to stay in California. My dad said come back, and he convinced me to come back. So I always knew it was going to be here. And then we were in like four locations, and the mayor said, we got an open hole on the circle. Would you think about putting the company there? And we said, yeah. Yeah. And never regretted any of those decisions.
You know, and I don't mean this is really going to sound like I'm kissing up here. Hell, you're not our boss anymore. So
yeah, you don't really. I'm surprised you guys will be on the air.
That's right. But
I thought it was a stranger walking in studio. Yeah.
That's right. But there is, and I'm simply asking if you're aware of this. For those of us like myself who grew up in Indianapolis and have a great pride in Indianapolis, there has been this security blanket of knowing that you were one of the people that was based here in Indianapolis because it felt like the city would never be in position to completely fail so long as certain pillars were in place. Were you aware of that, and does it come with pressure?
Well, I you are probably the single only person of the 6.5 million people in the state of Indiana who would believe that I would be a pillar that would save the state of Indiana. But no, I mean, I take great pride in the fact I've been involved in a lot of things in this town that I'm very proud of. I'm proud of the culture. It broke my heart when we finally said, look, we got to get out of the media business and do something else. But it's been a great source of pride to be here. I have friends from LA and San Francisco and New York and Chicago and everywhere and said, what are you doing there? But I love it. It's home. My family's been here for over 130 years. And so it's a matter of great pride when people ask you to help, you know, do the things that might make the city better.
I ask this a bit selfishly, so apologies on that front. But every morning when I drive down here, it's just an amount of gratitude I hope I have in doing what I love and so passionate about it and lucky to do it. What do you think the future is of local sports radio?
I think there's always going to be a need, and I think there's a better future for basically sports and news talk because it's local. I think the big failing of the industry is it stopped being local enough. I think a lot of the companies believe, and I think it was a function of having too much debt. And when you read the book, you'll see all that if you want to read the book. But there's something magical about the connection that you can't get anywhere else. And if you're a sports fan in this city, and probably 30% of the people here, maybe more, are sports fans, this is the only place you really go to get it. I will tell you, before we break, I can tell you an anecdote if you want. When we put sports radio on the air, it was different because they used to say that when you were in sports, and before sports radio, if you were a ball player or manager or an owner, and you got ripped in the newspaper, you got ripped, and you read the paper and it was done for the day. But with sports radio, it was 24 hours a day. So one of my dear friends, who was in Seattle, and kidded me and said, you know, I'm not a religious man. But he said, it's ironic that the guy who invented this stupid format that allowed every one of us to get attacked 24 hours a day is now an owner, and he's getting attacked 24 hours a day. And he said, it proves to me there's a God. But it did. It changed everything, and it's a forum for people. And so will it decline over time? I don't know. But I think if I'm going to bet on the radio business, I'm going to bet on the things that are local that matter to people. And this matters to people, you know.
Did you ever go to Kings Island and ride the Screaming Demon?
No, I am not a roller coaster
guy. Kevin, did you ever ride the Screaming Demon?
Jeff and I are the same.
Well, I'm the only one here then that's ridden a roller coaster upside down.
And that's why I named the book, because I ain't doing it. I did it with my life.
But there were parts, I'm assuming there are parts of the book that for you, while you were going through it, were an upside down roller coaster, right?
Yeah, there were, and I look at the book, and I think the thing I'm most gratified is that people have read the book, think it's really funny, and think there's some interesting lessons in the stories. They like the story. So it's been very gratifying, the initial response I've had. But going back through and living all of it, I go, wow, why did I pick this? Why did I not pick that? And you'll see a lot of those in the book if you choose to read it.
And again, people can find the book pretty much.
It comes out next Tuesday.
Okay.
And you can go. I'm getting into full sales mode. By the way, they never let me sell anything at this company. And they say, don't talk to clients. If you go right now to Amazon or BarnesandNoble.com or BooksAMillion.com or the Apple, whatever it is, bookstore, and just type in my name or Never Ride a Roller Coaster Upside Down, you can order it now. It will be released on Tuesday.
I love it. I love it. Awesome holiday gift, and I think I speak for Jeff or Jake and I, and certainly everybody here at the station. Thank you for everything,
Kevin. Yeah. And you, as I've said to you guys both, you guys do a wonderful job, really. And I can say that now because I'm just a fan. I'm not an owner anymore.
Can you call Alfred Liggins and tell him that?
Yeah. Put in a good word for us.
All right, thanks, guys.
I appreciate it. Again, Jeff Smullyan. Never ride a roller coaster upside down. The ups, downs, and reinvention of an entrepreneur, available basically wherever you can find books, and eventually will be available in audio form as well.
Got the pop quiz coming up in a few minutes. Let's hit a morning checkdown.
The Morning Checkdown, brought to you by Ball State Basketball. Get your tickets at ballstatesports.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Since Jeff Smullyan was just here, we'll start with college football. USC, his Trojans, are fourth in the college football rankings that came out last night. TCU is third. Michigan and Georgia, of course, are 2-1 respectively. Ohio State, the interesting one, sitting right there at number 5. They are 11-1 overall. Alabama, Tennessee, Penn State, and Clemson just behind them.
While we're on the college front, let's hear from Matt Painter and Mike Woodson. Tonight, the Big Ten ACC Challenge for the Hoosiers is in Bloomington, a marquee one with North Carolina, who has lost twice already this season. But in typical North Carolina fashion, they want to get up and run. Mike Woodson on North Carolina and defending them in transition.
Transition defense is important in every game that we play. All these teams that you play, everybody's trying to push. They got fast guards. They get the ball up the floor. So we got to get back and build our wall and make them go through our half-court defense. I mean, we can't have them running all over the gym and expect to win.
Again, that's 9:15 tonight. 7:15, it's Purdue at Florida State. They are a big favorite. This is not what we've been used to from the Seminoles here in years past. I think last I saw 15.5 for the spread. Purdue favored in this one. Shooting up to number 5 in the rankings here was Matt Painter now, and a little bit more of a bullseye on this Boilers team's back.
Just kind of human behavior, right? Just natural that, you know, hey, they beat Gonzaga, they beat Duke. Like, you know, we got to be ready. And now you get somebody who's a little bit more sharp because they see the success that you've had. Well, the people that are having that kind of success, like, you know, you got to have the capacity to get it too, right? And just be ready to play and be ready to compete and understand what you're, you know, what you have to do, but also understand it's a different game and a different style.
Speaking, by the way, of success, the Pacers have had that coming off their win against the Lakers. The Sacramento Kings have a 3-game losing streak, despite also having some early season success. Those two tonight, 10 o'clock in the association. That rounds out basically a full slate of games as the Pacers-Kings tip off. You can hear it at 10 o'clock tonight.
Game 3 of 7 for the Pacers on this big Western road trip yesterday in Qatar. It was the United States men's national team 1-0. So the U.S. moves on to the knockout stage. 16 teams now. Again, it's one and done from here. So no ties. We'll get penalty kicks and extra time and all that good stuff if these teams are tied after 90 minutes. Yesterday, the U.S., their one goal from Christian Pulisic, it sounded like this.
Robinson, back for the captain, Tyler Adams. Austin McKay, Des making a big run. It's meant for him. Des is snuck in behind. Des into the middle. Pulisic scores! Might have paid the price, but the U.S. takes the lead.
He did pay the price. Sent to the hospital, I think after halftime, a pelvic contusion day-to-day for the United States' best player, maybe him or Tyler Adams there. Captain, but Jake, I've watched several of the videos, kind of post-game locker room, hotel celebrations. When you play this sport where you're representing a country, it's once every 4 years, you've kind of been the butt of jokes a little bit in the sports world. Seeing these guys and their emotion, it's been pretty cool.
Yeah, it is pretty cool. And, you know, this was what was predicted, right? Was this the youngest team in the tournament and kind of make some noise, get your feet wet now, and then set yourself up for when the World Cup returns to North America in 4 years. So cool to see. No question about
That's
it.
That's rare air.
Thank you.
That is rare.
Appreciate
air.
That. The That's Dutch, good. 10 o'clock. I do like the Netherlands kits.
Now, they can kick the ball really far because of the clogs, but movement, not a strong suit.
Just in my opinion, that sucked.
That's why Jeff Smullyan decided to sell. Knowing what was,
I'll take the loss if I need to.
Right. Yeah, knowing what was coming down the road. Okay. All right, it is pop quiz time. 317-239-1070. Scotty J is in studio. Get Jiffy Lube oil change up for grabs. Scotty, your thoughts on today's pop quiz?
Harder than usual.
harder than usual. For Scotty to say that usually means very difficult.
That's what she said.
Give us a ring. 317-239.
What?
1070. Pop quiz time.
It's the Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes & Sons Restoration. Make your game day experience the best it can be. Log on and get your tickets now. It's BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Denny Smith for Sundown Gardens. Lots of Christmas decorations still on display at Miss Mary's Gift Shop. 20% off daily. 186th Street and Spring Mill Road. SundownGardens.com.
Hiring is personal, but don't do it alone. With Indeed's end-to-end hiring solution, you can attract, interview, and hire candidates all from one place. Visit Indeed.com/credit.
Are you kidding me? Gas prices are up again? Somebody has to do something.
Well, someone did. That's why I use Upside.
Upside? What's that?
It's a free app that pays you back real money for every gallon of gas or diesel you buy. I just earned 25 cents back on every gallon of this tank.
So the Upside app is free and you actually get cash back every time you use it? No strings attached?
Yep, it's awesome. Check it out. It only takes a couple of minutes to sign up.
Instead of just watching your dollars go into your tank, start putting money back into your wallet with the free app from Upside. With the price of gas today, it's big news and big money. To cash out of your Upside cash, just transfer to your bank account, PayPal, or a gift card. Upside users have already earned over $200 million. Now it's your turn. Download the free Upside app and get cash back on every gallon of gas. Use promo code ESPN17 for an extra 25 cents per gallon on your first fill-up. That's code ESPN17. Use code ESPN17 for an extra 25 cents per gallon back in your first fill-up. Cashback's not available in gas in New Jersey and Wisconsin.
Helzberg Diamonds presents the Holy Grail of engagement rings. Michael was getting engaged and needed a ring, but not just any ring, the engagement ring. The kind that when he saw it, he'd just know. So Michael looked around online, asked friends for advice.
I want a ring that's special. One that's, you know.
Oh. You gotta go to Helzberg.
Michael went to Helzberg Diamonds, where he found an incredible selection of beautiful rings, settings, and both lab-grown and natural diamonds, certified and guaranteed to be of the highest quality. He also met Sarah, a Helzberg Diamond expert, who helped him find that special ring he was looking for, so that when his fiancée opened the box...
Wow, it's...
Yep, sounds right to me. Be like Michael. Find the engagement ring of your dreams at a Helzberg store near you or online at Helzberg.com. And right now at Helzberg Diamonds, take advantage of special financing offers.
One of the best things that's happened in Indy over the past year is the arrival of QC Kinetics. I'm Kevin Bowen, and frankly, this might sound a little soft, but back to the old rocking life with baby Max has me feeling some back pain that I have not felt in a while. Well, QC Kinetics can give you relief every day to folks with chronic joint pain using the latest advances in regenerative medicine. The results can be mind-blowing, and these regenerative treatments are designed to repair and restore your damaged joint tissue with no drugs, no surgery, no side effects, no steroids, and no downtime. The success rate is incredible, and they're going fast. They've got clinics in Eagle Creek and Greenwood, and more are on the way. So don't continue to live with that nagging joint pain. Discover the exciting, all-natural, advanced options that we now have access to thanks to QC Kinetics. Call them today for a free consultation. That is 317-559-PAIN. Again, locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. 317-559-PAIN.
The Ride with JMV.
This team continues to get further and further away from what its owner has talked about regarding expectations. Not even close. And this is not just going to be a year turnaround. I'm not saying that everything is bad on this ship like Apollo 13, but there's a lot more bad than there is good. That whole first half was some of the worst football that I've seen in a long time.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. Have you studied? Can you handle the pressure? Sharpen your pencils. It's time for the Pop Quiz with Kevin and Querry. Brought to you by Jiffy Lube, Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
All right, I might distribute a few hints.
Oh, boy. Shocker. Thanks for the breaking news.
Is the sky blue?
Yeah. Again, the integrity of this Pop Quiz, it's a bit like the NLI sheets in the... NLI name, image, likeness, NIL sheets NIL. Of the SEC.
By the way, two house cleaning notes. First off, when it comes to house cleaning, just a reminder, Jiffy Lube does love helping out folks who help out other Hoosiers using their car. So thank you to Jiffy Lube, who you can always nominate Hoosier Heroes at the Jiffy Lube Indiana website. And somebody will be able to get 1 year of vehicle maintenance from Jiffy Lube if their car is the purpose, like, for example, Meals on Wheels, which is a fabulous organization, helping out other Hoosiers involving their car. Jiffy Lube is committed towards making life better for all of us in Central Indiana, and that is always appreciated. Number two, we had mentioned this earlier, and I'll mention this several times between now and when the Colts and Texans play to wrap up the season, but that game, which is tentatively scheduled, I believe, for January 8th, but is it possible, Kevin, they could play on the Saturday? I mean,
yes, but no.
Yeah, I mean, there's no way they're going to put that as a marquee
game.
4-win
Colts, right? And the 1-win Texans.
Right. So a lot of people just coming off of the holidays, if there are things going on or for whatever reason you cannot make it or decide not to go to the Colts-Texans game to end the season, but you have tickets for the game, maybe you're a season ticket holder and you're not going to use your tickets, if you would be willing to or be so kind as to donate those tickets, we've done this for the preseason and it worked out well. Yesterday, I got in touch with the directors of 100 Black Men, which is an organization through the United Way that works with different youth throughout the city of Indianapolis in a mentor-mentee program. Many of these students that would not have an opportunity to go to an NFL game under regular circumstances. If you donate the tickets by simply emailing me the tickets, because it's all electronic now, jake@1075thefan.com. Just remember the radio station you're listening to and my name, jake@1075thefan.com. If you forward me the tickets, you have till January 3rd to do so, so plenty of time to make up your mind. But if you forward me the tickets, I've gotten in touch with the United Way. They will be distributed so that kids with a proper mentor escort will be able to go to the
game.
That's
awesome.
So there you go.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Wouldn't it be awesome if that game ended in another tie?
Scoreless? It'd be like the World Cup, right?
Tie to start the year, Colts and Texans. Tie to end the year, Colts and Texans.
Boy, that feels like 3 years ago when they tied to start the year, doesn't it?
Gosh, Max was born that day before that. Notre Dame Marshall. We were blindfolding Max early in his young life from watching football.
Is that tie going to hurt them in the draft, you think?
It's definitely not helping them. Yeah, and we can get into this math project later in the week with Jake, but the tie means a half of a win.
Okay.
So when you look at the standings, you see all these 4-win teams, but yet you see the Colts at the 14th pick. But again, it's actually like 4.5 wins when you divide out the win percentage.
Yeah, I see. Okay.
So I know it's a little confusing, but the good news is for those that are all in on the tank, you're an 11-point underdog to Dallas, and then you don't play next week. It's a bye week, so that allows all those other 4-win teams to win a game. And then that should push the Colts up into the top 10. I fully expect the Colts to be in the top 10 of the draft order here in the next couple of weeks. All right, it's time for the pop quiz. Scotty J has called this one of the more difficult ones. And in scanning it, I would agree.
Okay. Plenty of hints galore.
And Jake said he will be handing out hints. No shock there. It's like Oprah handing out money.
That's right.
A number 1 through 8.
That's a good question, a number 1 through 8. Well, I'll just go with 5. I don't know. I just feel like 5 today. Johnny Bench.
A good question with a lazy answer. Let's go with Mike.
Mike.
What's up, Mike? Sir. How you doing?
Mike, where do we find you this morning? Are you in the car? Are you at home? Are you at work?
Driving up 31 on my way to Westfield, getting ready to go by the Shamrocks High School on my way to build an indoor putting green.
Whoa.
Okay.
Tell me more, Mike.
Yeah, right?
Mike, you've called the program before, right?
I'll give you my address, Mike. You can make a stop at my house.
It's been a couple months, but yeah. Called the program before.
Indoor putting green. How is this for a house, if you don't mind? For an office? What's this like?
Yeah, it's for a place of business. So I can send some pictures over to you guys after we get done with this terribly difficult pop quiz. If you'd like, looking good.
I was going to say, screw the pictures. Let's just install the thing downstairs. Now that
Kevin's getting all hot and bothered.
Yeah, you're going to get a lot of hints from me on this pop quiz,
yeah,
Mike.
Let's do it.
All right, here we go. Mike, would you like for me, that would be Jake, to lead you off, or would you like Kevin to begin the quiz for you?
Go ahead, Jake.
All right, question number 1. For the second straight year, Purdue faces Florida State in the Big Ten ACC Challenge. This is the 5th time the two have hooked up. Which of the two schools, or the 6th time, excuse me, they have done so 5 previously. Which of the two schools leads the all-time series? Would that be A, Florida State, or B, Purdue?
I would think it would be the Boilers. But if you would like me to change my answer to Florida State, I'll go with Florida State.
I'd probably change, Mike.
Is there an ESPN analyst named Mark Spears?
I think so. I believe Mark
with a C.
I think that's right. Yeah. But he. This is his favorite team of the two.
Let's go with the Seminoles.
Okay.
Number two. Jelani Woods had a career-high 8 receptions in the Colts' loss to the Steelers on Monday Night Football. The 8 catches, second most for a rookie tight end in Indianapolis Colts history. Who was the only Indianapolis Colts rookie tight end with more catches in the game? And you got to go back a bit for this one. A, Charles Arbuckle. B, Ken Dilger. C, Dwayne Allen. D, Dallas Clark.
You ever, Mike, you ever read Garfield the comic strip?
Let's go with Charles Arbuckle.
My man.
Garfield reference.
Question number three. Well, he got where I was going with that. Question number three. Yeah.
He's on with J&B. We're good enough.
He is.
Charles Arbuckle.
Yannick Ngakoue, who, of course, has been appropriately named and creatively named in a craze that's overtaken the city by me, Yannick Ngakoue, has recorded at least half a sack in 6 consecutive games, which is tied for the longest active streak in the NFL. Why, you ask? Because... you need Ngakoue.
In my opinion, that's
no, I don't think so at all. Who is the last coach? If he had Ngakoue, Jim Mora might still be here, showing that, in fact, he needed Ngakoue. Who is the last Colt to have a 6-game streak with at least a half a sack? Was it Dwight Freeney, Robert Mathis, Justin Houston, or Eric Walden?
Woof.
This guy's having a big year this year.
Go with Justin Houston.
All right, Mike. Number four, the U.S. men's national soccer team advanced to the World Cup round of 16 with a 1-0 victory over Iran yesterday. Yesterday's win came on the heels of the Americans' 0-0 draw with England on Friday. In which decade did the United States men's national team last post back-to-back shutouts during a World Cup? 1990s, 1970s. 1950s or
1930s?
1930s. Wow, Mike, that was strong.
Question number five, Mike. Name the only player in Major League Baseball history to have a season with at least 50 extra base hits, 50 stolen bases, and 100 walks.
Fifty extra base hits,
50 stolen bases, and 100 walks. Only one player has done that, and he actually did it 4 times.
That's pretty wild.
I don't know if Ricky Henderson ever had enough extra base hits, but he probably had a bunch of doubles. Oh boy.
I'm gonna give you multiple choice.
Whoa, 4 for 4. Looks like Jake's getting an indoor putting green.
Ricky Henderson, Joe Morgan, Ty Cobb, or Ichiro?
Go, Ty Cobb.
Okay.
I love Ichiro.
Do you really?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Okay.
Speaking of a Mariner.
My all-time favorite player, by the way, was the answer for question number 5. Florida State was correct for question number 1. Mike off to a good start. And I was super impressed, Mike,
that's a W,
with the fact that you seemingly knew that John Arbuckle is the owner of Garfield. Thus, he got Charles Arbuckle.
Justin Houston, the last coach to have a 6-game streak with at least a half a sack.
And Mike Strong with the 1930s for question number 4.
That's rare air.
Question number 5. He said Ricky Henderson.
Without the multiple choice initially.
Then went with Ty Cobb, but it was the guy that was the teammate of my motivation, Johnny Bench, for picking caller number 5. Joe Morgan, the correct answer. Joe Morgan.
You blew it!
Mike, strong effort. Enjoy the putting green.
You don't get to come back tomorrow. You don't even get a lousy copy of our home game. You're a complete loser.
Kudos to the Pacers because... they have hope, they have direction, and they have promise. The Colts, on the other hand, are a huge vat of uncertain suck.
Thanks. That's one of my favorite lines you've said.
Vat of uncertain suck?
Okay.
We hope that's not Mike's effort installing
that
the putting green.
That was early yesterday, was it not?
That was.
Because I barely remember saying it.
You came out swinging on that morning, which is rare for you.
How much do you think a 15-foot indoor putting green would cost?
15-foot indoor putting green.
15 by 8 feet.
$2,500.
Why don't you ask Mike? Right here.
I don't know. We still have Mike?
Yeah.
Mike, how much would that cost?
No comment.
Oh.
No, it depends what you want. I mean, what you said 15 by 18?
15 by 8. Nothing crazy.
15 by 8. Okay. Well, I mean, we could definitely hook you up. I mean, how many oil changes am I getting?
Well, that's a great question.
Things that's called payola right there, which is not right. Frowned upon.
Mike, I might slide into your DMs, vice versa.
Slide into your DMs.
Topic. Appreciate
okay,
you calling.
That's not uncomfortable at all.
Oh, my. That's
Could Tom Allen be on the move? We'll chat about that to round out the show.
If your car is less than 10 years old, there's likely something hidden in your radio. Another way for you to listen to The Fan. Go to 93.1 and look for the HD radio button. Press it, and you'll hear The Fan everywhere.
On Wednesday, November 30th,
the hottest ticket in town,
AEW makes the return to the Indiana Farmers Coliseum at the Indiana State Fairgrounds for its only live show of the year. AEW Dynamite and AEW Rampage promise to be one of the biggest events of the year. Don't miss Kenny Omega, The Young Bucks,
oh, wow.
MJF.
I'm a generational talent.
Saraya.
The revolution.
John Moxley.
Get in the ring with me. It's dangerous as all hell.
Ryan Danielson. Claudio Castagnoli. Dr. Britt Baker, DMD. Jamie Hayter. Eddie Kingston. Orange Cassidy. The Acclaimed.
Everyone love The Acclaimed.
Swerve in Our Glory. Jade, FTR.
Tough guys out.
Tony Storm. Wardlow. Chris Jericho. And the Jericho Appreciation Society.
And that's entertainment.
Darby Allin. Sting. And many more will be there live.
Oh!
Don't miss AEW Live at the Indiana Farmers Coliseum. Tickets make a great holiday gift and are on sale right now. Go to AEWTIX.com now. Card subject to change.
Meet Joe A.
Hi.
Joe B.
Hello.
And Joe C.
What's up?
Three everyday Joes perfecting their banking with Chase. Joe A is locking his lost debit card with the Chase mobile app. Joe B is cruising toward his new ride with AutoSave. And Joe C's Chase banker is helping him budget to go back to school. Tools that help protect, support for what's next. One bank that puts you in control. Visit chase.com/checking. Chase, make more of what's yours.
Chase mobile app is available for select mobile devices. Messaging and data rates may apply. JPMorgan Chase Bank, NA member FDIC.
Time to fire up your laptops for Cyber Monday savings, because the Home Depot has the tools to make your holiday magic with new savings every day. So start clicking and adding everything you need for the tech lovers in your life. Or grab one of our nailers, combo kits, or trimmers to surprise any doer on your list. Everything you need for the holidays is just a click away with free delivery on eligible online items. The Home Depot, how doers get more done.
Indiana Physical Therapy is your trusted choice in Central Indiana. For over 30 years, we've treated all walks of life, from peewees to professionals and Olympians, and everyone in between. Schedule at any of our 21 convenient locations, even without a doctor's order. Indiana Physical Therapy is cost-effective, accepting all insurance plans and networks. We're open from 7 to 7 and can get you in the same day you call. Go to IndianaPT.com.
This week at all 26 Payless liquor stores, get Jim Beam's 12 Days of Whiskey for only $7.99. Sterling's 12 Days of Cocktails are only $34.99. Payless also has Chloe Chardonnay and Pinot Grigio for $9.99 a bottle, and Coppola Diamond Chardonnay is also $9.99. Plus Old Forester 86 and the 1.75 liter is just $31.99, and Bud Light and Coors Light 16-ounce 12-packs are $13.99. And don't forget, December the 10th is Payless Liquor's huge holiday event from 11 to 2 at the E Street location. Don't pay more, get more, and pay less at Payless Liquors.
Tickets on sale now for Christmas Nights of Lights at the Indiana State Fairgrounds. Purchase online early to reserve your time slot. Reservations are required. Christmas Nights of Lights is brighter than ever this season, as they have added several new light displays to their show of over 2 miles of driving route. They're excited to reveal one of their most creative and colorful light displays, the Field of Lights. Christmas Nights of Lights is open nightly, all holidays, rain or shine. November 11th through January 1st. They are reservations only, so purchase tickets at ChristmasNightsOfLights.com.
At Progressive, you can get 24/7 protection, even if you break the space-time continuum.
We did it. We time traveled to yesterday.
Wait, Progressive covers us 24/7, but we just created an 8-day week, and it's 24/7 coverage, not 24/8. We gotta go back.
Are you joking right now?
Shh, I'm calling them. Hi, I have a question about time travel.
Progressive offers more than a great price when you bundle home and auto. We offer round-the-clock protection, which literally means anytime. Coverage from Progressive Casualty Insurance Company affiliates and third-party insurers and subject to policy terms. Bundle discount not available in all states or situations.
It's a championship triple header on American Standards College Football Saturday. The coverage begins at 11 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Carry on my wayward son. There'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest. Don't you cry no more.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Jake Jeff Brom's going to join us tomorrow at 8 o'clock.
That's pretty awesome, considering we'll be, at that point, within 60 hours or so of the Big Ten title game, right?
Yeah, 8 o'clock on Saturday night, Purdue and Michigan. That's, I believe, Fox. So then I think that would be Gus Johnson and Joel Klatt on the call of that one. I really enjoy Joel Klatt as a color announcer. I think he's really good.
Now, who is your ultimate dream team when it comes to?
I mean, honestly, I'm looking forward to Sunday night because I do like Tirico a lot on the call of Colts Cowboys. Boy, I know he didn't hold back with his assessment of Matt Ryan the other night. I do enjoy Troy Aikman. I appreciate his candor.
Yeah, Aikman's really good because he's just kind of a cool guy, but at the same time, like he kind of has earned the clout of being able to say whatever. Like, who's going to question him, right?
Plus, I feel like you get in that quarterback fraternity a bit, and like they're kind of afraid to say some stuff, or you know, they oftentimes cover up for the quarterback. And boy, he did not do that the other night. How about this from The Athletic yesterday, Jake? You see Hugh Freeze to Auburn?
Yes.
So he leaves Liberty. Liberty is, I think, thought to be one of the more resource-abundant group of five schools. They're going to join the Conference USA, I think, coming up here. If it's not next year, maybe the year after that. And a name thrown around for Liberty, and in the article it said, industry sources have thrown the name Tom Allen around.
I think that would be a really good fit for a couple of reasons. Number one, Liberty, if I'm not mistaken, as a university, is a very faith-based school.
Yes, uh-huh.
And I think that fits well with Tom Allen.
In Virginia, by the way, for those confused where Liberty is.
Number two, I don't think Tom Allen is a terrible football coach. I don't think he's a Big Ten football coach. And number three, hallelujah, people in Bloomington would be doing backflips over the Liberty of getting out from underneath the Tom Allen contract, which is like the he has the fourth highest buyout in college football. Literally in 1 year where Indiana played in front of no one, and they had a great year in the COVID year. Don't get me wrong, they had a great year, but there were a lot of things that needed to be like tempered a little bit in terms of evaluating it, and Indiana was like Cameron from Ferris Bueller's Day Off, where they just decided to go ahead and marry the first girl that, you know, loved them, and so boom, let's go.
Plain as white. All three faces together. Living out our DNA today, baby. Living it out today.
What about resiliency?
Isn't it relentless?
Yes. Relentless. Sorry. Yeah.
Relentless.
Okay. I didn't realize his buyout continues to be $20 million through next season.
Yeah. I mean, it's the fourth highest in college football.
I thought I read in there like he would owe Indiana $4 million, I believe, if he were to leave. I mean, it would be quite the it'd be quite the ego check to do that, and also a bit of a financial hit.
If I'm Tom Allen, I'm not going anywhere.
Right.
I'm not going to say any names because I don't want to disparage anybody, but I know one coach who coached at a Big Ten school and was fired and then had offers elsewhere and was like, no, I'm not going to take any offers till my contract's up because I want them to have to pay me every single dollar of my buyout because to hell with them. You know what I mean? I get it.
I think the Liberty connection is Hugh Freeze had Tom out on staff at Ole Miss back, you know, probably over half dozen years ago now. So that's not a direct connection necessarily to Tom Allen having coached at Liberty, but who knows if that'll play out at all. You know, I thought about this with Stanford's opening. What about Pep Hamilton for Stanford?
Boy, that's interesting. Yeah, because he'd been there before, right? Wasn't he the OC there?
OC there under Harbaugh. Currently the OC of the Texans.
Would that give them a little pep in the step?
It's not one of your best.
Sorry.
Curious to see what happens with Stanford's football program. Like, Harbaugh and David Shaw had them on a level that I think is very difficult to achieve. And if, you know, we had Jeff Smolian in studio with us a little bit earlier, if indeed they do go to the Big Ten, you know, what type of relevance are they going to have on the football level? Because it got ugly there late in the Shaw era.
Like, how awesome would it be if Washington and Oregon joined the Big Ten, which I think will inevitably happen. But, like, for Indiana or Purdue, either one, to be able, there would be no greater trip than to go out to Seattle to go watch them play at UW. Are you kidding? I mean, I realize if you had Stanford, USC, UCLA, Washington, Oregon in the Big Ten, it's not like you'd be going and playing out there every year, right? I mean, it would be the league would be so big with 20 teams in it that there would probably be – you probably would only go to Washington, like, every 4 years, right?
Oh, I would guess less than that. I mean, Purdue's playing Michigan Saturday night. They've played one time in the last decade.
Isn't that crazy?
Now you're going to add more teams. And I'd assume Purdue and Indiana would be in the Eastern Division.
Right, right, of course.
And then they would not be in the Western Division. But nonetheless, I mean, some road trips that obviously...
I mean, to go watch Indiana or Purdue play at Pauley Pavilion?
You do not get... I just still think about it from an Olympic sports standpoint. Yeah. Wednesday night soccer match in Seattle.
No question. I mean...
just wild. Tonight, again, a lot of basketball. 6:30, Butler is going to host Kansas State. It's undefeated Kansas State over at Hinkle. 7:15, it's Purdue at Florida State in the ACC Big Ten Challenge. Purdue an overwhelming favorite for that one. Indiana's hosting North Carolina at 9:15. I still take the Hoosiers comfortably with that 4.5
Indiana by
12 spread. I might look at an alternate line there for that one. And then Pacers-Kings. Our coverage begins at 9:30. You've had these Western Conference matchups for the Pacers this season that have had, like, some fun other storylines, and tonight you've got a ton of them. Turner against Sabonis, Haliburton and Hield going back to Sacramento, Benedict Mathurin. He doesn't need much motivation, I think, on any night, but clearly with how he reacted to Jaden Ivey earlier in the year, I assume that he would have a similar reaction with Keegan Murray.
I'll be curious to see how Tyrese Haliburton is received in Sacramento. Because you would think that the Kings fans have to... I mean, it wasn't his choice, obviously, to be traded. But he has really blossomed. I mean,
right. You
know, 40 straight assists since his last turnover.
Which is just incredible.
Yeah.
I mean, you talk about a guy that's in full control quarterbacking the Pacers offense. I mean, I thought the play he made to find Nembhard for the game winner was so, so just calm, collected, didn't panic. How many times do you see guys in that moment just chuck up a shot, throw it in the corner, first guy they see that's
totally
open, he gets it to Nembhard, get it off in time, game
and
winner.
Then for Nembhard to be able to get the release of the shot without panic and without rush.
Sure.
You know, with LeBron James closing in on him, I mean, it's pretty
impressive.
Especially
him,
stuff.
Jake. He's not, I mean, he wasn't the go-to guy at Gonzaga.
Correct.
Or the go-to guy at Florida.
Correct.
You know, in college, so.
IU, win margin 11 plus, plus 240.
Win by 12.
I would entertain it. I'd entertain it. Jeff Brohm going to join us tomorrow at 8 o'clock. Looking forward to that conversation. Everybody have a great Wednesday. We'll chat with you then.